Hello, everyone, and welcome once again to RacerTV.com's coverage of the 2015 Mountaineer Run here at Marvin's Mountaintop in beautiful Masontown, West Virginia. It's a glorious Memorial Day weekend, 2015, and we talk about battles and conflicts. We have battles and conflicts going on all over the place. In our XC1 class, Caleb Russell, still out front defending that points lead, has a huge gap on the rest of the pack, but not the same story in our XC2. Six guys want to win and can win, and it's going to be a battle to the very end here today at Marvin's Mountaintop at the Mountaineer Run 2015.
And thanks a lot, Megawatt Matt Watson, as we join you down here live from the starting line of Martin's Mountaintop for this continuing coverage of the Rocky Mountain ATVMC.com Mountaineer Run GNCC, the final race of the weekend. Our XC1 and XC2 Pro Lights class riders and Pro Riders on row number one, the two Pro Lights riders on row number two. Our A and B classes all joined in behind them. Some 220 riders on the starting line for today's racing action. As we get set to roll, let's meet our starting lineup. As they are all now waiting patiently in turn number one, the world's greatest off-road racers in the world, as we shut them down, guys, and get set to meet these XC1 Pro riders in accordance to points after six rounds of racing here in the 2015 championship season. Rolling to the line first today, he rides aboard the number one, a two-time, a defending GNCC motorcycle champion, as well as a five-time winner here in the 2015 season on the factory FMF KTM from Boonville, North Carolina, Caleb Russell. In the absence of Josh String, rolling to the line second today, third in points, the young rookie aboard the number 314 from Belton, South Carolina, a former XC2 Pro Lights class champion on an Infab Am Pro Yamaha, Brad Baylor. Rolling to the line today, fourth in points, fresh off his first ever GNCC racing win. He rides aboard the number nine from Crown Point, Indiana on a JCR Racing Honda, Chris Bach. Rolling to the line next today, he is fifth in points aboard the number 989 from Williamstown, West Virginia on a Rocky Mountain Amsoil KR4 Far Husqvarna, Van Duval. Rolling to the line next today, fresh off a podium race finish in New York 2 weeks ago, he rides aboard the number 264, a former motorcycle and supercross great from Akron, Kentucky on an Air Group Rockstar Husqvarna, Ryan Sipes. Rolling to the line today, seventh in points, he is aboard the number 3 Ampro Yamaha from Cookeville, Tennessee, backed by the great folks at Infab and Ampro Yamaha, Jordan Ashburn. Rolling to the line today, eighth in points, he rides aboard the number 6, your defending national enduro champion from Birdsboro, Pennsylvania, on a Rockstar Energy Husqvarna Factory Racing, Husqvarna, Andrew DeLong. Rolling to the line next, he is ninth in points aboard the 514, a former XC2 Pro Lights class champion himself, suffering from injury over the course of the last three seasons. But here at the midway point, his first time ever with the opportunity to race here in the great state of West Virginia from Marvin's Mountaintop, says he's ready to make things happen today. Out of Belton, South Carolina, on a Mototech KTM, Stu Baylor. Rolling to the line today, 10th in points. He hails from Japan, a former Japanese cross-country champion, riding aboard the number 12 on an HR Motorsports Motivations Racing Great Western Motorsports-backed Honda, Takeshi Koiketa. Rolling to the line next, he rides aboard the number 25 from Morrison, Illinois, on a Fun Mart cycle. Fly Racing, RidePG.com, KTM, Adam Bolnar. And last, and certainly not least, from Cincinnati, Ohio, riding aboard the number 20, backed by Maxxis, KTM, and Fly, Chris Douglas. And that, ladies and gentlemen, your starting lineup for the Rocky Mountain ATVMC.com Mountaineer Run GNCC, round 7, the midway point of America's premier off-road racing championship and the world-renowned AMSOIL GNCC Series, as the machines fire up one final time. And our starting sequence will be getting underway here in just a few moments. Beautiful sunshiny weather greeting us from high atop Marvin's Mountaintop as we celebrate the unofficial kickoff to summer 2015 and pay homage to those many men and women that gave their lives so that we could live free as Americans and be able to experience great things like this, GNCC racing, and anything we want. A very honorable day and an honorable weekend here. And a great place to do it as we overlook the GNCC racing nation itself, the heartland of it all, where it all began, moments away from the Racer X and Racer Productions home offices, from which all of our direction comes from here in the GNCC Racing Nation. Within just 1 hour, about 6 tracks that helped build what we know as America's greatest off-road racing championship all took place over the course of the past 41 years here in the great state of West Virginia, Pennsylvania, and as well over in the great state of Ohio. Well, today here we are back to the great state of West Virginia. And 220 riders in the afternoon race alone await the signals from Ricky Towery. That will begin a 3-hour process that could be some of the most toughest, grueling, and exciting moments of these riders' lives today. Could we see another game-changing moment taking place here in GNCC Racing? As we mentioned, we're in the halfway point of the season, right smack dab in the middle of 13 rounds, round 7. And already we've seen some things start to shake up a little bit as this championship over the course of the last 2 rounds. The young Stu Baylor putting the pressure on there just a month or so ago, 2 rounds ago. And then last race it was JCR Honda rider Chris Bach taking the win and stopping Caleb Russell's undefeated streak here in this 2015 season. Will Caleb Russell get back to his winning ways? Will Thad Duvall make it to the top of the box here today? Or will we see a whole new player in the game of GNCC racing? And as we get set to go here today, we can see that a few moments are going to be taken extra to ensure that we have our morning race wrapped up and all the riders off the racetrack. We know that the race has been wrapped up for a little while. About 10-plus miles of mountainous and rocky terrain that we're cleaning up nearly 400 riders from this 10 o'clock race this morning and ensuring utter safety throughout the entire GNCC nation. And that's what we're waiting for right now. The all systems go from the sweep crew as well as the all systems go from our friends over at Timing and Scoring. And at this time, it could be some of the toughest times for a lot of these guys as the adrenaline has already began to flow here this afternoon. And they are chomping at the bit, ready to take it and make it happen. And they're firing back up, and we're only 2 minutes away. Signal coming away from Ricky Towery there now, who stands in turn number 1, our maestro, if you will, the conductor of ceremonies. All of our start process from this point on is directed by that man right up there. And right now, Ricky Towery is in communication with Scoring. He gets the all systems go from them. He has the all systems go from the track crew. And now he's about to tell the racers here on the starting line, it's all systems go as we are approaching 1 minute before the start of this Rocky Mountain ATVMC.com Mountaineer Run GNCC. And now the adrenaline begins to flow once more as these riders begin their final steps and process before the start of the racing action. The next signal we get from Ricky Tower will be the blue flag, which will be to shut them down. And it will also signal less than 30 seconds for the start of this race. Shut them down, guys. Shut them down. Shut them down. Shut them down. We are now less than 30 seconds away from going GNCC racing here on Marvin's Mountaintop. And I got to ask you, West Virginia race fans, are you ready to go GNCC racing? Come on, West Virginia. This is the heartland, the birthplace of GNCC racing. I'm going to ask you one more time. Are you ready to go GNCC racing? 10 seconds. And row number one, the XC1 Pro, will be off and rolling at a Rocky Mountain ATVMC.com Mountaineer Run GNCC. A $250 all balls whole shot award up for grabs here today. And it's Caleb Russell. Russell right behind him, the number three of Jordan Ashburn, and Ryan Sipes getting off to another solid and strong start. It looks like the young Grant Baylor as well in a top four or five position there as they head through the third turn. XC2 Pro Lights, Nick Davis, Lane Michael, Jason Thomas, Craig DeLong, Jesse Crum, Sam Evans, Luke Parsons, Michael McGinnis, Trevor Bollinger, Corey Buttrick, Austin Lee, Lucas Tatum, Jared Stock, Ricky Russell, Scott Grills, Philip Chaney, Michael Witkowski, Ryan Lojack, Alex Benhart, Tegan Temple, Zach Nolan, and Colin May all ready to go from row two. The XC2 Pro Lights in 10 seconds. And they're off. And it's going to be a Husqvarna ride, the number, I believe, the 18 of Craig DeLong, taking that one out of Morgantown, Pennsylvania. Husqvarna support team rider. 258 class coming up next. We got Alex Seagart, Vincent Smith, Mason Atherton, Evan Earl Cornealy, Dave DeVinny, Will Mason, Russell Smith, Cole Kirkhoff, Vance Francis, Aaron Bartholow, Nolan Cypher, Eric Douglas, Mark Koretzko, Sean Benhart, Mason Pratt, JoJo Bowden, Brandon Peterson, Connor Karkowski, Joshua Catch, Caleb Ward, Anthony Stone. 10 seconds. Colton Wilkes, Paul Petron, RJ Cook, Cordis Brooks, Tom Devlin, Brandon Gearing, Alex B. Roth, and Jonathan Johnson as the green flag waves on this one. Intensity in the turn number one. Oh, look at this, the 178. Gonna seal the deal here. That's Corey Neely out of Gibbon, West Virginia, as we turn our attention now to the four-stroke A-lights class with Brady Myers, Braxton McGee, Joshua Lee, Van McCarron, Christopher McManus, Dawson Dunnock, Hunter Shelton, Jeremy Donnellan, Tanner Wade, Tyler Braniff, David Muchisco, Tristan Landon, Logan Papoul, Jake Froman, and Dylan Dela Cruz. As the four-strokes A now turn their attention to Ricky Towery, he readies these riders and lets them know it's time to roll in. 10 seconds. And row four is off. The four-stroke A lights. 862. Jake Froman out of Obermeyer Suzuki. Suzuki USA Fly Racing Machine. A good jump off the line, but it's going to be the 100 of Joshua Lee from Statesboro, Georgia on a Kawasaki back. Kawasaki MSR Decal MX machine getting the hole shot there. Open A class. Zach Hayes, Nathan Thornhill, Timothy Murphy, Nathan Ziklow, Jesse Kildo, Dalton Cross, Ben Parsons, Seth Eberhardt, Sam Forrester, Luke Ross, Duel Murphy, Dylan Rash, Harley Wheeler, Lorendo Sylvia, Cody Jeffers, Joshua Brown, James Glover, Tyler Costner, Tommy Henderson, Brandon Higgins, and Andrew Boggs.
10 seconds.
Wow, Nathan Thornhill off that start line like a rocket. Let's see if he can do something with it now. And it looks like he will from turn one to turn two. Nathan Thornhill, Pecksmill, West Virginia, AOMC MX Fly Racing, FMF Racing also sponsoring that rider, senior 840 plus class. So shotgun Sean Remington ready to roll. Harry Englehart, Frank Tussle, Dwayne Connor, Patrick Davis, Carl LeBlanc, Brian Gudoff, also Billy Schlag, Edgar Davis, and Mark LaBelle. Senior A, 40-plus, ready to roll in 10 seconds. Oh, yeah. Oh, mercy. Wow. Who was that? 410 Billy Slagger. No, that's the 418. Not sure who that is, but our Kawasaki rider all over the place out there. That was Billy Schlag. Up next is the Vet 830 Plus class. He didn't get the whole shot, but boy, he made a lot of interesting things up turn one. Joe Marsh, Joe Kessler, Big Jim Steiner, Jesse Arsenal, also Eddie Lojack Jr., Logan Mills, Fabian Barada, and Tom Truxell. 10 seconds. And we got a KTM pilot in this Vet A30-plus class. It's the 409, the formula of Logan Mills out of McDonald, Ohio. 200 A-class, Zachary Ferentz, John Hugel Jr., Christopher Venditti, Clint Masters, and Logan Lowry ready to roll next. Five riders in this 200 A-class. We say it before, not a lot of riders, but a lot of intense competition ready to roll in that first turn. And 10 seconds. .263, gonna get the, yes he will, he'll steal that, nope, make it the 41, gonna steal the lead away now. That's your Yamaha pilot, Chris Vendetti, out of Fort Mill, South Carolina, Junior AB 25+, Jedediah Haynes, Joseph McCarty, Jordan Overfield, Kyle Isert, Aaron Coxon, Brandon LaDon, and Eric Breitmeyer. 10 seconds. Junior AB 25 plus off and rolling now. 426, that's, or 416 maybe, Kyle Isert. Let's see if we can get the number. Actually, I think it said the 044. That was Joseph McCarty grabbing the lead in that one. As we go next to the 250B class, we got 22 riders, Zach Perry, Mike Miller, Tyler Murphy, Will Hart, Brian Clementowski, Max Horesco, also Judd Lott, Evan Scholes, Joseph DePalma. 10 seconds. Devin Beyer, Cope Becker, Gregory Coffey, Connor Keegan, Ryan Earl, Adam Anderson, Billy Seglia, William Bryan, Coleman Brinson, Justin Murphy, Brewer Carly, Jonathan Catanzaro, and Noah Martz. 458. Coleman Brinson out of Aiken, South Carolina, taking the early lead in that one. 200B class coming up next. Zachary Hugo, Cameron Sisk, Bolton Biroth, Matt Bruffy, Adam Parker, Jake Ross, Aaron Lasher, Jonathan Bidlack, Parker Jones, Colton Cup, Caleb Williams, and Austin Lilly. 200B class ready to roll. Ricky Towery readies them and lets them know. 10 seconds. And they're off. Kickstarts are down. They roll into that first turn now. .371. That's Adam Parker out of New Kensington, PA, on an Alias Garnet 412 Motorsports machine. Then we go to the Vet B30-plus class. We got Larry Hopper, Ronnie Brown, Sean Morris, Matt Jankovitz, Brandon Clayton, Jansen, or Jason Wilson, Mike Udovic, Timothy Nethkin, Dan Nyanko, Timothy Brendlinger, Matthew Ukovitz, Tommy Curtis, Jeremy Dexler, Wesley Lance, and Scott Dallin. 10 seconds. Ooh. That B30 Plus class off and rolling. It is the 195, 445. Oh, what's is it going to be? The 445. Well, the 195, Sean Morris out of Waynesburg, PA, and they're going back and forth right now as we go down to, looks like Open B class racing next. We got Tyler Anderson, Tyler Rose, Roman Phillips. We got Joshua Atkins, Bill Zavendi, CJ Seisinger, Jesse Eisen, Antonio Vitale, Michael McLean. 10 seconds. Ryan McManus, Chris Bartoon, Andrew Wilson, James Harshberger, Michael Hall, Eric Saunders, Greg Shell, and Dustin Stanley. 5:19. Ryan McManus from Nelsonville, Ohio. JD Performance Sports Cycles and Attitude Salon sponsored rider gets the whole shot out there. Man, it's the Attitude Salon. It's the haircut that makes him go so fast. Senior B, 40-plus class, Scott Campbell, Charles Altimas, Mark Proper, Seth Linder, Mark Atkins, Devin Ferguson, Robert Cornish, Michael Beckett, Leon Whittever, Will Gribben, Carl Cumston, and also Mike Kochman. Ricky Towery waiting to give these riders their next cue now. 10 seconds. And the green flag waving yet again. Wow. I love it. They all go out wide, and it's going to be, I believe that says 218. Charles Altimas taking the early lead in this one. Altimas from New Florence, PA. Four-stroke B lights class coming up next. We got Adam Hollenkamp, Trey Jefferson, also Damian Wanderings, Randy Skidmore, Mike Tetlow, Adam Lewis, Mac Faint, Drew Bolton, Austin Evans, Alex Ankrum, Logan Henderson, and Daniel Spurgeon. 10 seconds. And they're off. Trey Jefferson from Westminster, South Carolina, the 283 Yamaha, taking off with the early lead in this one. And opening up with a few bike length lead there as we check down on the starting line. Looks like we've come to the end of our start order. Some 220 riders now making their way to the mountains of West Virginia from here atop Marvin's Mountaintop, overlooking the GNCC Racing Nation. And
I'm a sore loser.
I'm a sore loser. Losing is not an option for me.
Be the best.
The best.
The best.
You have to have the best equipment under the hood.
That's why I
only use
Kometic products in my engines.
Kometic gasket. Kometic gasket. Kometic gasket.
Kometic gasket, a superior quality gasket
for those of us who demand the highest level of performance.
This Racer TV live broadcast is brought to you by AMSOIL, the first in synthetics. By Rocky Mountain ATV MC, get ready. By Maxxis Tires, find your flow. And powered by Yamaha Generators.
welcome back to Racer TV Live here from Round 7, the Rocky Mountain ATV MC Mountaineer Run in Masontown, West Virginia. We've got all our starts off and rolling. Caleb Russell taking the lead in the XC1 class with our hole shot award, and they're out into the woods, and kind of a little bit of a parody there. We had Caleb Russell with the hole shot, and last round winner Chris Bach did not start on the starting line, and he was the last rider to the woods. So I'm here with joined by Matt Watson, and we're in the Racer TV studio calling the action for you here today. We'll be joined by Rodney Tomlin here in just a few moments. Matt, you were out and about a little bit. What did you see so far here this morning?
What I saw was 100% great conditions. I worked my way into the woods just a bit, and you know what? There's still a lot of traction out there, Johnny. There's still some moisture in those shady sections. We don't really have any standing water other than one little mud hole out there. And look at this. We're running through the grass track and the field sections with almost zero dust. A beautiful Memorial Day weekend here on Marvin's Mountaintop, and we're going to see great racing.
And as the folks tuned in at home are watching the racing action, you can see the fields here, and you know they look kind of unassuming. The track looks as though everybody's navigating it with quite a bit of ease. What you can't see is just behind the wood line here, it goes into some gnarly rock sections. It's some of the toughest terrain that West Virginia or anywhere in the country has to offer. We've got hills, we've got ravines, and most importantly, we've got some jagged rocks that just love to eat motorcycles.
Johnny, the topic of every podium so far this morning were those rock sections. Legendary hillbilly rock gardens here in West Virginia. You know, all born and bred from the beginning of time back in the 100 Miler series with the Blackwater 100, the Big Bear 100, which is only a few miles from here also. And that's what you can always expect when you reach the mountains of West Virginia.
And we're here in the heart of GNCC racing country, as we've talked about so many times so far this weekend. A number of the GNCC facilities in the past have been just miles from here. So this, obviously, in the shadow of the Racer Productions offices, and this really is the heart and the soul of GNCC racing right here. And here in just about 3 hours, we're going to find who can navigate this course the best, and somebody's going to come out on top.
I tell you, I was surprised yesterday, Johnny, and just like this morning, Jesse Ansley taking the win. That guy's a Florida guy. He races and trains down south. He came up, navigated the rocks with no problems, and got it done for the overall this morning in our youth bike race. Vance Earle, Phil Smith, not necessarily rock riders. Those guys from the south. I believe Phil may be from up north a little bit, but not used to rock gardens like this. So you might be surprised by who comes out on top.
Well, the one thing about GNCC racing is if you want to be in contention for a win and in contention for a championship, you have to be good in all conditions. And this track is one of the toughest of the season. Obviously, we've got the snowshoe round coming up in two more races, which is known to be the toughest of the tough. But I got to say, there's some sections here in the woods at Masontown that are just as bad. You know, it really is hard to keep your momentum going, especially me being an ATV guy. I just can't fathom trying to navigate some of these sections on two wheels. You'd have to have incredible balance, incredible throttle control. And I think what we're going to find out today after 3 hours of racing, the guys that are up front are going to be the guys that make the fewest mistakes, not necessarily rode the fastest.
Johnny, that's absolutely, I was going to say, it's going to be a matter of mistakes today. Who can manage those mistakes and not make any and keep them to a minimum? You talk about the local terrain. Well, the variety of terrain that you can find in such a small area is what makes this place so unique. You can find the fast sections. You can find the tight technical stuff. You can find the rock gardens and some mud as well. And a lot of places you're not able to put that kind of terrain together with the elevation change.
Absolutely. And as we're watching the finish line section here, we see a whole lot of AMSOIL banners. So now would be a great time to talk about our AMSOIL Twitter contest. Any of you listening at home or anybody with good enough cell phone service here at the track, if you want to get on Twitter and tweet your podium finisher predictions to hashtag GNCC Live, that gives you a chance to win $250 in AMSOIL products. The winner will be chosen at random, so you do not have to have the podium riders correctly. You just have to take a guess at it. So, Matt Watson, I'm going to put you on the spot. Your call today for the top three overall. Who are your podium prediction for the AMSOIL Twitter contest?
Caleb Russell, Thad DeVaughn, Chris Bach.
All right, there it is, folks. So he called it. We're going to lock it in. Now's your chance to lock yours in.
Now it's your turn, man. Who are you calling?
You know, it's really hard to go against Caleb Russell here this weekend. I mean,
Fair enough.
Having grown up not far from here, ridden these conditions. But at the same time, you know, I try not to play favorites here a whole bunch. But watching Chris Bach get his first week race win 2 weeks ago in New York, you know, obviously spent a lot of time with him. So here's my predictions. I'm going to go with Chris Bach for the win, Caleb Russell for second. And I'm going to go a little bit outside the box here. Andrew DeLong coming back from injury. He's been getting stronger each race. I know he's tough on the rocks. He's got great throttle control. I'm going to throw Andrew DeLong in there for third.
Well, I think that's a smart deal. Play the wild card without question. And I started not to pick Caleb, but you know what? Like you said, even though the contest, you don't have to have the right finishing order to win, although the winner did 2 weeks ago, didn't they?
I think we've had that happen twice so far this year.
Yeah.
The winner, who was chosen at random, actually did have the top three podium finishers in order. So, you know, it helps to give it a little thought. Maybe maybe karma just comes your way if you get it right.
Right on, for sure.
And we're watching some of our other classes battle their way through. Now, it's worth noting that the finish line is at the 11-mile marker. The race actually started just after the 6-mile marker. So this is only about 5 miles in that we're watching. Our leaders are much further out on the course. They're actually into, technically, if you're watching live scoring, they're on lap 2 already. First lap yesterday, I believe, was about 10 minutes, and it's a little bit shorter today. So that may be a little bit confusing for the viewers at home, but keep in mind, as you're watching the laps, they've already completed a lap of racing, although we just started just a few moments ago. So they got underway, they went about 4 miles, and then they made it to the finish line, set out towards lap 2, and that's where our leaders are now. They're working their way through the gnarly rock sections, through the obviously great condition fields that we've got. And, you know, we've got so much slick dirt out there, it's crazy to see out in the fields, like you said, it's tacking up, and we're actually seeing dust kick up, as we saw yesterday.
Johnny, I want to ask you something. When you went back into the woods right here, this left-hander, back by that big rock up there, I heard it got nasty and steep and tough to navigate in there.
Yeah, you know, there's honestly so many sections, as I said, just into this woods line, just out of sight from the pits, from the pro pit area that we're sitting in right now in the Racer TV studios. If any of you here in attendance have an opportunity, ask a course marshal, ask one of the staff workers, ask one of the team members. You know, you can literally go just 100 yards from the pits here and you can see some amazing racing action, not only in terms of dicing and battling, but the technical skill that it takes to ride a track like this is phenomenal, as I said. And these guys are, they'll make, you know, Caleb Russell, Chris Bach, Andrew DeLong, all those top pro guys, you know, Thad Duvall is incredible to watch his bike skills. Get into the woods, get a look. Just down below the Racer TV studio here, there's a mud hole that was unassuming and easy this morning. And in talking to some of the morning riders, it's opened up to 8, 10, 12 lines wide because everybody's trying to get in there and get through as quickly as possible. And they're just blazing trees over and making it happen.
And when you get to that spot, Johnny, spend 20, 25 minutes there. So you wait till the leaders come around so you see all debris of riders navigate that same section. And you'll be amazed, like you said, at how Thad, how Chris, how Caleb make that same section look so easy after you spend a half hour watching people flounder and dog paddle.
You know, and not to take anything away from our amateurs here. I mean, these are some of the best amateur racers in the world here competing in their respective classes in GNCC racing. But at the same time, as you said, Matt, you know, when you see the XC1 riders come through, and even those top XC2 guys, it's phenomenal. Their feet never come off the pegs. They look like trial riders. Incredible balance, amazing throttle control, and they'll walk through there almost as if they're on rails.
Yeah, I tell you, when you watch the average rider come through, and like you said, there's just such a plethora of different riders here. When you have a rider like Caleb come take that same section, not dab a foot, not twist the bars, not get offline, man, it really shows the years of dedication and the training it's taken to get to that place, because a lot of our other riders, they have daily jobs, they're in school, they have a lot of things going on. So it's just like comparing Ben Roethlisberger to your local high school quarterback.
Yeah, absolutely. But, you know, as we talked about, we've got all different racing going on this weekend. We had yesterday, we had ATVs and UTVs. We had youth ATVs. We had amateur ATVs in the morning, and then the pro race, obviously, at 1 p.m. Today, the same thing. We had our, as you mentioned, Jesse Ansley, who is a pro rider in his own right, although he rides a 105cc machine. You know, so we've got classifications for all types of riders. If you've never been to a GNCC and you want to check it out, obviously, you can go to the website at www.gnccracing.com. All the information you need to get started is there. But you can come out, and you could be battling right on Racer TV Live. You could be coming your way through the AMSOIL banners right now like this guy is on screen. You know, and with all these different classes, there is a little something for everybody. And it's great that this is one of the few forms of sport or motorsports where you have the amateurs out on the track at the same time as the pros. So not only are they battling within their respective classes, but at the same time, they're out there on the same track sharing TV time with the best off-road pilots in the world.
Johnny, it's not only the most fair platform in the world, it's the most accessible. As you said, come pay your fee, come sign up in the right class, and you two are going to be riding on the same track that Caleb, Thad, Chris, and all these guys are tearing up. And yesterday, the same way, man, a great amateur crowd in our ATV racing. And I got to ask you, that dirt looked so perfect yesterday. Now, a bit of moisture gone today, a bit more dried out today, but Johnny, holy cow, some of the best conditions I think I've seen all year.
You know, Matt, I always try and be a positive person, but we'll just say that this place isn't my forte. The dirt was better than it's ever been here. The conditions were great. We got a little bit of rain on Friday evening, that it was going to be. And here is our leaders. Looks like Caleb Russell with running that reverse number plate, signifying he is the points leader and he's the leader in the race right now. And that looked like Thad Duvall in second behind him. So Thad had a decent start. They're saying that might have been Ryan Sipes. I thought it was Thad, but they're saying it may be Ryan Sipes. So we'll wait and see. But you can see whoever it is, those two have checked out, and they are really starting to get up the field here early. And now we see Andrew DeLong. So DeLong into the third place, and he works his way through, which that is actually a hard pin road there with just a little bit of water that's run down that creek and filled it up overnight. Those guys will have that splashed out within a lap. And now we've got Chris Bach, after starting last, has worked his way up to fourth. Looks like he's hard on the gas, trying to chase down the leaders. And that looked like that was Thad Duvall then in fifth place. So I believe our Racer TV producer, Jason Hooper, was right. And in the sixth place ride, that is Jordan Ashburn. So and couldn't see who that was, but it looks like it was Grant Baylor, who also had a terrible start. Both the entire field was in the first turn, Matt, and it was Chris Bach and Grant Baylor still sitting on the starting line kicking their machines. But as we see, those guys have worked their way up through the pack and made short work of this first lap. Now, keep in mind, this is now lap two, 25 minutes, 41 seconds in. They're at the 5 mile marker. So they've already completed lap one, which was a very, very abbreviated lap. And now we see Stu Baylor working his way through on camera. He's got that right radiator shroud already flapping in the wind, indicating that he's made contact with the tree. But that's not going to slow Stu Baylor down one bit. You know, there's a man that's determined, and as we've talked about, after riding through so many injuries, he's ready to get some good finishes. And there is Jason Thomas, XC2, possibly leader, and that may have been Nick Davis possibly behind him. Hard to tell from this angle who the riders are as they're coming by, but as we saw, it was Caleb Russell leading. We're assuming, we believe that was Ryan Sipes in second, Andrew DeLong in third. They're showing Jason Thomas fourth overall.
I thought maybe that he was up there a little higher just a minute ago when they come through. It almost looked like he was in fourth or fifth place.
Well, that was actually definitely Jason Thomas we just saw on screen, but we have to keep in mind he has a one-minute time correction. So after that, they're saying that he's currently running fourth overall. That was definitely Craig DeLong that just went by, who was our XC2 whole shot winner. So he's running about third in XC2 right now. So the XC2 riders, being as technical as this course is, they've really turned up the heat this first lap, and several of them have worked up their way. It looks like we've got four XC2 riders inside the top 10 overall currently.
And so far, it looks like all of our picks are running inside the top 10 so far. It looks like we're going to be in good shape for a little bit till this race comes to us a bit, till the track comes around. And as these guys progress into this third lap, then we're going to see traffic definitely become a factor.
Absolutely. And with the lap times being the way they are, this is going to be one of those races that we're really going to be on the cusp of whether or not we have a 6, 7, or possibly even an 8-lap race. I'm assuming we're going to see lap time somewhere in the neighborhood of 30 minutes. But being we had that shortened, abbreviated first lap that was only about 4 miles long, that first lap, I didn't actually catch the lap time. We'll have to see if we can get some results up here on screen in just a moment. But I'm assuming it was probably in the 8 to 9 minute range for our leaders. And it was 8:57 for Ryan Sipes, 8:59 for Caleb Russell. So just under 9 minutes. And with that in mind, I think we're going to end up seeing a 7-lap race. We're going to see that shortened first lap and then 6 full laps to make just probably barely over 3 hours will be our finishing time here. But we'll wait and see how that shapes up as time goes on. Now we see some of our 258 riders starting their way, work their way by. Now our leaders are on screen again at the 7-mile marker. This is just above the pro pits. Caleb Russell, hot in chase. There is Ryan Sipes.
And, you know, we saw Ryan really come into his own at New York. We know Ryan's got the speed, got the ability to win. It's a matter of just putting the whole program together sometimes, Johnny, and getting the chips to fall into place. And I can tell you this much, Ryan was excited to come here. He likes this place. He likes the rock gardens. He likes the rough technical stuff. And, you know, a great place to be sitting on lap number two, right behind your leader watching his lines.
Yeah, and now we see Andrew DeLong still in that third place ride. Looks like he's all by himself there. And he's about 25, 26 seconds behind Caleb Russell and Ryan Sipes. Next, we should see the JCR Honda of Chris Bach, who was in fourth when we last checked in. And there he is in fourth place, the number 9 Honda of Chris Bach. And in fifth, I believe that is Thad Duvall. And there he is on the 989 FAR Husqvarna. And sixth place, I believe that was Grant Baylor. And there is Jordan Ashburn.
Yeah, when you look at the gap we have right now on this second lap, Johnny, one of two things are going to happen. A couple of these guys are going to get together and push their way to the front, I think, or a couple of these guys might slow each other up getting into a bit of a battle here early in the race, because we're looking, I didn't see your timer there, but we're looking at seven guys less than 45, 50 seconds apart.
You hit the nail on the head. There was about 49 seconds between first and seventh. So you got about the top six or seven. Now we wait, and we should see, there is Stu Baylor. We should see our XC2 leaders coming on screen here just about any minute now. It should be Jason Thomas, Nick Davis, when we saw them last, and they were working their way through when we saw them at the five. And there is Jason Thomas, and that is Nick Davis. So they're still 1-2, just like when we saw them last on screen. And I believe it was Craig DeLong who was in the third place spot last time. Ricky Russell was also up in there. And we have Chris Douglas. There's one of our XC1 riders running inside the top 10 within his class. He was 10th overall when we last saw. Great ride for him. He's really been coming to his own these last few races. Adam Bernard, the number 25 machine on that KTM. Another rider that's been poking his head into the top 10 several times in the last few rounds. So those guys have been pushing each other. They're from near each other. And there we see, I believe that's Tegan Temple, the number 525 KTM rider, who's been a podium contender several times and actually landed on the podium for the first time last weekend in New York. There is Craig DeLong, and I believe we may have seen Lane Michael. There he is. He's a local boy, obviously, from Morgantown. Matt, you've worked with him for many years. He's got to have a little bit of extra confidence and swagger coming into this weekend.
You know, he does, but they made a major change. Johnny, I'm not sure if you're familiar or not. They put a Fox shock on the back of the Honda this week. They've had a few blown shocks this season. I know you've talked to him. They've had some saggy bridges, as we like to say, with the rear end, and just having a few issues late in the race. They went back to stock shock a couple weeks ago, went back to basically stock settings. They had a FCR modified shock, and now this weekend, Rick and Lane told me they switched to a full Fox unit, so we'll have to see if it's going to take a little setup or not, but really expected to see Lane a little closer to the front right off the start, getting aggressive and going for it here at home.
Well, that would certainly be bad news for the competition, because Lane has been on the podium already a number of times this season. I believe he finished second at our race in New York just 2 weeks ago. He was definitely on the podium, may have been third, but I believe he was second. And if he was experiencing shock fade issues and still able to land on the podium, if he can get those issues squared away, he certainly would be a contender to win these races. While we were talking about that, we saw Ricky Russell work his way through. That was Scott Grills, both running with inside the top 10 of the XC2 class. And we could see the dust really kicking up now. There's Mike Witkowski, the number 282, who we expected to be an XC2 contender this year, went out early, I believe in round two, with the shoulder injury, and is now back contending here this weekend. Actually, I believe his first ride back was 2 weeks ago in New York, so he's back up and contending for possible top 10s in the XC2, and we expect to see the rider who was a top amateur overall winner many times last season even get further up within the XC2 ranks as the season goes on.
Well, Johnny, history proves itself. This XC2 class will heat up like a Memorial Day barbecue when these guys get together. So all I got to say is I'm going to sign off and let Rodney Tomlin sit down a minute, let you guys enjoy this race together a bit. Guys, keep me posted. I'm going to set up some podiums, keep an eye on what's going on in the pits, and I'll check back in with you.
Perfect. And thanks always, Matt Watson, for your race analysis and great at-the-track announcing, helping us out here on GNCC Live with Racer TV. And now we are watching 33 minutes approach, and we see Scott Grills is actually into the MCS Yamaha pits. Looks like they're making an adjustment to his shifter. They had a big old pair of channel locks out there, so that leads me to believe that he had probably bent that shifter in, and there's certainly plenty of obstacles out on this course that could do just that, to bend a shifter in. Now we're joined by our man, Rodney Tomlin, who was calling the starts there. Rodney back in the studio here, and man, things are heating up here early with Caleb Russell with the early lead, but Ryan Sipes is tagged onto his rear wheel, and those two have set a pace that, at least so far early in lap two, about halfway through lap two actually, nobody's been able to match that pace. Those guys have pulled about 35 seconds clear of third place.
Yeah, I tell you what, you got to give it up to both Caleb and to Ryan Sipes. Caleb, number one, you know, he's out here to make a statement, I think, today after that last race 2 weeks ago and coming up just a little bit short. But you got to hand it to Ryan Sipes as well. So I think he may be continuing on the high that he left off of in New York a couple of weeks ago with that podium position finish. He rode a good, solid, strong race that day, finished probably, I mean, he's been on the podium before, but I got to say that was probably his strongest finish we'd seen. He himself looked good after the race, and the positiveness that he carried into this race pre-race today was just amazing. That was a good race.
Well, and I got to be honest, Rodney, to see Ryan Sipes do well in a race like Florida is no surprise. You know, to see him run in podium contention, and even where we saw him on the podium at Ironman, you know, there's good dirt there, great traction. You know, we've seen a number of riders who have the speed that can contend at a track like that, but typically what we see at a track like New York, which there was a lot of shale and rock and hard pack there. Now, granted, there was a lot of grass track and fields too, where, you know, any of the XC1 guys will tell you, hey, man, if I got one rider behind me in the fields, I don't want it to be Ryan Sipes. This guy carries phenomenal speed in the fields. His motocross background allows him to just carry so much speed through the corners. But at the same time, that track was technical. There was more tree roots on that track 2 weekends ago in New York, possibly than any course we've had yet this season, and will have, save for maybe Snowshoe. And for him to be on the podium, that says a lot, not only about his abilities as a rider, his training, but also his technical prowess and also his mental strength that it takes to compete for 3 full hours. He's proven that he can do that even in the toughest of conditions. And speaking of the toughest of conditions, today, I believe that is exactly what these guys are going to face. This course is going to continue to get slicker. Out in the fields, it looks so unassuming. You're seeing dust kicking up. You're seeing great traction. These guys are leaned over on the side knobs of these tires. They're making it look easy. But in the woods, it is nothing but pure chaos. I can assure you that. You know, there is just rock gardens that do want to do nothing except for eat parts off of motorcycles and reach up and grab, you know, foot pegs, shifters, take riders to the ground, anything that they can possibly do to slow these guys down. But the top guys, what they've done is they're trying to make it look smooth. They're trying to bounce right across the tops.
And you know, honestly, that's exactly the ticket to going faster. If you can smooth out that ride, going across the tops of those ruts and staying out of those and crisscrossing some of those turns and so forth, it does smooth out the ride. It speeds up the ride. And look at this. Here's some speed coming at the finish line right now. And it looks like he's back out front in the number one spot. It is Ryan Sipes leading Caleb Russell and Johnny Gallagher. I'm not saying, you know, what's going on with Caleb at this point, but what I am going to say, what has gotten into Ryan Sipes at this point?
Rodney, I turned my mic off. I was going to let you talk for a little bit, but I turned it back on. I'm jumping in here. Wow, this has really shocked me. Caleb Russell coming back. You knew he was going to be just on the gas hard this weekend, trying to get away early. Not only did Ryan Sipes lead for a bit, latch onto the rear wheel of Caleb Russell, but now he has repassed Caleb Russell, and he's going to lead the end of lap two as he comes by Ricky Towery. Ricky Towery signals that those guys have now completed lap two, and with a lap time of
27:52.
So these guys have really turned up the heat. I was expecting lap time somewhere in the neighborhood of 30 minutes. These guys are under 28 already, and as we know, guys like Caleb Russell, man, it's not uncommon for them to turn the heat up even further in the race. Andrew DeLong is really on a charge today. He looks great, Rodney.
Exactly. You know, that's exactly what I was about to point out. This is a style that I've seen out of Andrew today that I haven't seen in a long, long time. Well, I would almost have to go back as far as some point last season since we've seen this kind of riding out of the number six machine. But I'll tell you, he's coming off of a good high from last weekend. We know that Caleb Russell won the National Enduro, but Andrew DeLong was able to get a podium himself, so he's back into that mojo and getting things rolling again.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, I've been up to near Andrew DeLong's house and seen the conditions that he rides in, and you know, as much as I talk about how technical this course is, this is like Andrew DeLong's backyard. He's used to these conditions. Rodney, I want to point out real quick the two riders that checked through in the fourth and fifth place position were Chris Bach and Thad Duvall. Those are two riders to keep an eye on for certain. Obviously, our top three running a great pace. Chris Bach coming fresh off a win last weekend, or 2 weekends ago in New York, and starting last today, already working his way up to fourth. That coupled with the fact that Thad Duvall, who is racing essentially in his backyard, and we know rides these conditions phenomenally. If you're ever going to see bad Thad just decimate the competition, it's likely to be on a track like this. So with those two guys hooked up, there's plenty of confidence between those two. I think we're going to see those two push up and possibly close the door on Andrew DeLong. And if they do, then you're going to have three riders that together could very easily close up that gap on Ryan Sipes and Caleb Russell on
most
front.
Most certainly, and I like the way that things are starting to look. You look behind them, back in the number six spot, it is Grant Baylor, so add to that that mix. It's going to get pretty exciting as the day wears on. You look back at last round for Chris Bach when he won. He also started out rather sluggishly, but was able to get things rolling as the race progressed, and he's right where he needs to be. It looks like nearly everyone is right where they need to be on the racetrack right now to create for us as race fans a spectacular race day.
Yeah, and while we're talking about two riders that could potentially hook up and push to the front, we saw Chris Bach and Thad Duvall, we mentioned, in the fourth and fifth spot. But then just behind them, as you mentioned, was Grant Baylor and Jordan Ashburn, nose to tails in the sixth and seventh spot. So there's two NFAB and Pro Yamaha teammates that are going to push each other. Jordan Ashburn, with those long legs, I honestly believe has to have an advantage in some of these rock gardens. You know, we talked about the goal is for these guys to stay up on the pegs, push hard, and Wow, look at this. We've got a shakeup in the top five overall. Jason Thomas into the fourth spot with a 28:33 lap time. That looks like he has actually, moved into fourth place overall. Yep. And then in sixth place overall is Nick Davis. So those guys running both inside the top 10 overall on corrected time. And actually Tegan Temple as well in the 10th spot. So we've got three XC2 riders in the top 10 overall, which, as we were talking about a little bit earlier in the show, the slick conditions, a lot of times the XC1 guys will kind of pace themselves that first lap, feel the track out, and then let the race come to them. These younger, kind of more zealous XC2 riders, obviously Jason Thomas not so young, but the guys behind him are, and they push hard that first lap, and they're right up in there battling for these top 10 overall spots.
Well, of course, with that, Johnny Gallagher, you're exactly right.
I mean, Jason Thomas is younger than me. Don't get me wrong. I'm just saying,
No.
We say young guys, I don't think that we can call Jason Thomas a young guy.
He's not a spring chicken.
It takes an old guy to know an old guy, so Jason's cool with me.
And one more note before we go to a commercial break real quick, pointing out the fact that Jason Thomas, coming from England, he will tell you that mountainous, rocky-type terrain is something that he is used to riding in. Talk to Nick Davis today, and if you know anything about his history, he is also used to riding in rocky, mountainous terrain. So that kind of lends itself to a good reason as to why these guys are going so well today, and as well here strong in the top 10. Jason Thomas up to fourth place as we check it out. Ryan Sipes leads Caleb Russell by about 3 seconds. Andrew DeLong another 36 seconds back in third. Then it's Jason Thomas fourth overall. Chris Bach rounds out the top five, and GNCC Live continues from Marvin's Mountaintop after this.
The Sunstar Work-Z rear sprocket is made of stainless steel, making it three times more durable than a standard steel sprocket. Team it with the 520 XTG triple guard sealed ring chain with three lubrication pools per side. Durability in the toughest condition.
General RV is going to help you go camping. With locations across the nation and thousands of RVs to choose from, General RV is the nation's largest family-owned RV dealer. At General RV, you'll save thousands on everything from trailers that sleep the whole family right up to motorhomes that are amazing and so economical to travel in. General RV is the only dealer who can show you this much and save you this much.
Do you love racing? All kinds of racing? How about pro motocross? Flat track? Road race, ATV, GNCC, Supermoto, Enduro Cross. Well, we've got what you're looking for. Welcome to the Racer X Show with Greg White, presented by Chaparral Motorsports. New every Tuesday on RacerTV.com.
And welcome back to GNCC Live here on RacerTV.com. Rodney Tomlin along with Johnny GNCC, Johnny Gallagher, and Megawatt Matt Watson as we roll through this Mountaineer Run GNCC. And it is Ryan Sipes continuing to lead Caleb Russell. Andrew DeLong back in the number three spot as we are now some 44 minutes, working on 45 now into this race here from Marvin's Mountaintop in West Virginia, Masontown, West Virginia, overlooking what I like to call the GNCC Racing Nation, the stomping grounds there, and only moments away from the RacerX home office as we check out some of the more gnarlier conditions. We see out in most of these field sections that when we're getting to see these riders, it's kind of a fast-paced, high, you know, open field section where they can get a little speed and you know, make up some time out there. But right here, this particular section near the 5 mile marker, a little different today than what we were witnessing there yesterday. At least I didn't see this in yesterday's shot, but we got a little mud out there, Johnny, and folks were asking yesterday, where are those guys getting the mud? I guess it was from here, huh?
Yeah, we've actually got several sections that are kind of low-lying areas, and this place kind of all drains to one valley, and the water will come off the mountain. We had some rain on Friday, so it sets kind of in pools up on top, and then slowly works its way down. If you walked across any of these hillsides, there's rain ruts. You can tell all of it runs down to the bottom. Well, there's about three or four places where we cross those bottoms, and what happens is all that water slowly works its way down. As we can see on camera here at the 5 mile marker, that's got a hard bottom, but where that guy is over there, you don't want to be. That doesn't have a hard bottom. Up here up top, we've got a hard bottom. The low line that this guy's probably going to try and wheelie across here in a minute. Oh, these guys are going to drop their front ends down. Again, hard bottom, but in between there, that's soft, it's mucky. You don't want to work your way into where? Into there. In the past, we've actually had this whole section be underwater. This year, obviously, things a little bit drier, so not quite as bad. But as they work their way down the trail just a little bit further, it dips even further into that valley, and there's standing water and muck mixed together with these West Virginia rocks that make for some treacherous terrain, and it's really testing these guys. But that what you see on camera here at the finish line, and as they work their way through at the 5 mile marker, even at the 7 mile marker, dust kicking up, great conditions. So we've got a little bit of everything for these guys here today, Rodney.
I think so. That's the great thing about this Marvin's Mountaintop. It kind of takes everything that a GNCC is kind of known for and mixes it all together, and it's a perfect match. And like I said, I'm just being here within just well, an hour of probably six different facilities at one time over the course of the last 41 years helped the growth of GNCC and help elevate it to where we are now and needing these bigger facilities and places like Marvin's Mountaintop to go racing from.
Yeah, you know, and Rodney, you and I talked about this yesterday. I mean, through the roots of GNCC racing, it started out as a much smaller regional series, I guess, if you would, the 100-miler series. And Big Dave Coombs had a dream. He wanted to make this the premier off-road racing series, not only in the country, but in the world. And here we are some 30 years later, and Dave Coombs himself set the wheels in motion that have turned into Racer Productions, his family, people like you, everybody else that has been involved in this organization since the beginning, have built this just absolute mega series that is officially the biggest off-road racing series in the world, drawing riders from all over the world to here to compete. Obviously, one rider of that international flair that's missing a little bit this weekend, we'll go ahead and point out, not with us this weekend, is Josh Strang, who I believe is third place in points currently, second place in points even. He held on to that despite having being just kind of out riding around in New York after a shoulder injury the week leading up to. So that Rockstar Husqvarna factory rider, not with us this weekend, choosing to stay home, strengthen up that shoulder. Kind of heard through the grapevine that he's really trying to get strong and come back out swinging at the Penton in hopes of potentially contending for podium positions or some real point salvaging positions that could help him hang on to some championship hopes for this season.
No doubt, and hopefully that's going to happen. I was talking with him there 2 weeks ago. He was I guess he didn't make the call until 7 o'clock the night before or just after lunch, and made his way to New York at 7 o'clock the night before. So it was a last-minute decision then, and probably a good decision this weekend to set this one out. As we continue to roll along here from the Mountaineer Run GNCC, we are working on lap number 3. Two laps of racing are down. As far as the standings go right now, it is still Ryan Sipes, Caleb Russell, Andrew DeLong, 1, 2, and 3. Time adjustment again has Jason Thomas in fourth overall. Chris Bach, who would be physically fourth on the track, is running about 3 seconds off the pace of Jason Thomas. But here's an interesting factor to point out. Chris Bach turned about a 7-second faster lap last time around than what Jason Thomas did. So be neat to see what happens with time adjustments, as they were only a couple of seconds difference on elapsed time, believe it or not. So Jason must have had a really good burner there on the first couple of laps in order to, or first lap anyway, in order to get Chris in that position. But it's going to be interesting to see how and if Chris Fox is going to be able to dig himself out of that hole. Nick Davis is running back from the number six spot. Duvall is seventh overall. Grant Baylor in eighth overall. Jordan Ashburn ninth overall. Tegan Temple rounding out the top 10. That is for your overall. As far as the XC1 and XC2 classes are concerned themselves, Sipes, Russell, DeLong, Bach is fourth, Duvall is fifth. Baylor is sixth in class. Jordan Ashburn is seventh in class with Stu Baylor eighth. Adam Bourneau ninth. Chris Douglas rounds out the top 10. The XC2 Pro Lights has Jason Thomas, Nick Davis, and Tegan Temple 1, 2, and 3. Ricky Russell just outside the top 10 overall is fourth in class now aboard the 212. Trevor Bollinger, who's had a little bit of a struggle the last few rounds, and actually this season, if you talk to him, he's put a lot of pressure on himself, said he's relieved the pressure this week, and just kind of trying to go back to some old ways and make it fun again, and hopefully that's going to be working out for him. Looking at things right now, it's not far off pace back there in the number five spot. Lane Michael, who is a kind of hometown boy here with this one, running back in the number six spot. And we got a little bit of a message coming in there.
What we're looking at here, I've got my phone out and I've got the Strava app. We were talking about some riders out with injury. I did just notice on Strava, which is a training app, Charlie Mullins posted, enjoying my last ride for a while, surgery tomorrow, got to go get my wrist view, so bummed. So,
oh, man.
I guess that it's out there on social media. I guess it's okay to talk about. Charlie is going back in for surgery, so we're hoping. We've all been watching and following, waiting for Charlie to be back here at the track doing battle with his teammate Caleb Russell and the rest of the XC1 riders. So him having posted that, I guess it means it's going to be a while till we see Charlie. So Charlie, if you're at home listening, we wish you the best with your recovery. We want to see you back out here on the track battling for wins like we know you will be very soon. But in the meantime, wish you and the family the best on your recovery.
No doubt. That is a tough break. Those injuries are heartbreakers, no doubt about it. And especially... Charlie's injury's been a heartbreaker. As we've seen, you see this happen rarely, but when it happens, it's hard on these guys. I know that Stu Baylor has been struggling for the last 3 years with his injuries and so forth. And I think that Charlie, though, we know that he's been struggling, but the good thing about Charlie is he's really not tried to push the envelope too much. If the doctor said don't ride, he doesn't ride. If he says don't race, he don't race. So he's been following the doctor's orders, and hopefully that's going to translate into positive things at the end of his recovery period.
Yeah, absolutely, and that's so tough when you're coming back from an injury. Obviously, the racer in you wants to be out there on the track. You almost have to kind of just withdraw from anything that reminds you of racing at that point if you want to truly sit and take the recovery time like the doctors are saying.
Yeah.
And do the therapy that the therapists are telling you. It's got to be so tough, but again, Charlie, if you're at home, you're tuned in, or if you get a chance to catch this, we wish you the best and hope to see you at the track very soon.
Maybe we'll give him a call sometime and talk with him online.
And one thing that we're seeing on screen is Ryan Sipes still in the lead, the 5 mile marker. We're seeing the number 264 machine work his way by on that Rockstar Air Group Husqvarna. Right in behind him, though, still that factory FMF KTM of Caleb Russell. These two have pulled out a little bit of a gap. We'll have to see just where Andrew DeLong, Chris Bach, and the rest are. But for the time being, they're not in our camera shot. So those two still clear and still pushing hard. Rodney, I'm really impressed with Ryan Sipes. We can't talk about it enough. Again, technical track, slickery conditions. And he's out there leading the way in possibly what we believe to be, the results believe to be the most dominant off-road rider in the country right now.
Yeah, exactly. And that's saying a whole lot for anyone at this juncture in Caleb's career, especially for a former motocrosser who's only been racing GNCC for now a season and a half.
Yeah, and Rodney, I went ahead and started a clock. We can actually see off screen out the corner of our Racer TV studios as we do see now our third place rider, and it is the JCR Honda of Chris Bach, and it looks like Andrew DeLong behind him there. We'll have to wait and see in the fourth place now ride, and there is no Thad Duvall into fourth place now, so DeLong has dropped back even further, and that may have been DeLong that just went through our camera shot there in fifth. We'll have to wait and see. Nope, there is DeLong there. So it looks like DeLong may have actually dropped back to the sixth place spot, and now Grant Baylor in the seventh place spot. So these guys have kind of shaken things up a little bit in the 5 miles since we saw them last here on lap three. Chris Bach now into third. Into fourth is Thad Duvall. So like we talked about, those two pushing, and although I got to say, they don't seem to have made up any ground on... It looks to be about 51 seconds, if my timing is correct, from Caleb Russell to Elliott. And that actually Jordan Ashburn, who we missed, is now hot on the heels of Thad Duvall. We missed that on screen, but saw it out the corner of the studio here. So that makes up your top five. So we've got Ryan Sipes leading the way, Caleb Russell in second, Chris Bach in third, Thad Duvall in fourth. Oh, and look, Andrew DeLong off to the side of the track over there talking to his mechanic, Joey Maurer. Looks like they're discussing him possibly going back to the pits. Throws his hand up. They're running towards the pits. He's headed back out on the track. They're obviously going to meet him over in the pits there. So we'll probably head over there and see if we can get an update after they get a chance to get that machine fixed or whatever his issue may be. They're at a dead run to the pits. So definitely some issues there for Andrew DeLong, which is unfortunate because he was running in a podium spot there in third place.
Yes, he was. There goes Stu Baylor at the 5 mile marker on screen. And watching the action outside the Racer TV studio, just kind of like right out in front of our studio. And wow, that's a heartbreaker. We're going to be getting some video of that, and we'll try to get some audio to find out what's going on. I think Matt Watson will be heading down there here shortly.
And actually, as they're coming about the 5.5 mile marker outside of our Racer TV studio, I do see Jason Thomas, and hot on his heels is still Nick Davis. So those two have been locked up in a battle all day long, Rodney, and they are still wheel to wheel. Looks like that may possibly have been Lane Michael, who's now worked his way up to the third place. We'll have to wait and see when they check in at the finish line, or we can get a little bit clearer shot when they work their way through the pits. But again, we know the top two and XC2 are still wheel to wheel. We'll just have to wait and see who is now in that third place position, battling it out for that final podium spot there. Now we see on screen Tegan Temple at the 5 mile marker, who was our early third place rider and was also on the podium in New York just 2 weeks ago. Looks like he's dropped back just a little bit. Now we see here at the 7 mile marker, we wait, and Ryan Sipes on screen, and it looks like he's pulled out a little bit on Caleb Russell. So not only is Ryan Sipes leading, but now he is pulling away from Caleb Russell. Caleb Russell is losing ground to Ryan Sipes on a technical West Virginia racetrack.
Wow.
Rodney Tomlin, I am floored.
I have to agree. I am probably right there beside you right now, Johnny Gallagher. 2 weeks ago, I watched, and it looked as though Caleb was struggling a lot, but I attribute a lot of that, I think, to maybe a missed setup on suspension and things. But as I watch Caleb push here today, it looks like, at least at the moment in this section of the track, that the suspension seems to be working okay. I'm not a suspension expert, as you deemed me last race, but nonetheless, watching the suspension work, it seems to be a lot better than it was in New York. But man, look how smooth things are for Ryan Sipes right now. Are we witnessing another monumental and historic moment in GNCC racing here on this Memorial Day weekend?
Well, let's hold on just 1 second here, Rodney. It's 8 seconds is the gap between Ryan Sipes to Caleb Russell, first place to second place. Before we start handing anybody wins, we got to keep in mind there's still a lot of racing left, and Caleb Russell has won a lot of races in the last few years, and he's done it by doing exactly what Caleb does, which is when he comes under fire, he stays calm, he responds, and he rides his own race. So right now, Ryan Sipes setting a blistering pace, which is exciting for us. It's exciting for the fans. Caleb Russell probably not so impressed. He was wishing Ryan would maybe back it down just a little bit, but at the same time, let's not by any means start giving anybody winners trophies. Caleb Russell is a dominant force in GNCC racing.
Oh, come on. You can see it with the changing of the guards happening right before our eyes, Johnny Gallagher.
And we're going to see a battle for the win, no matter between what riders it is. But how exciting for right now. And now we see the third place rider of Chris Bach as he works his way into the pits. We'll have to see. Looks like not going to be fueling this lap. So as these guys finish up lap three, it looks like the majority of these guys are going to be going on a one-pit strategy. There we see that was actually Andrew DeLong that just worked his way past on screen at the 7 mile marker. Now we wait at the 8. Should be a matter of just maybe 30 seconds until we see Andrew DeLong in the pits, and we'll find out exactly what issue it is that he's experiencing. On screen now, Jason Thomas on that number 17 Watsy KTM there in second place to FAR. Factory Husqvarna of Nick Davis. Those guys 1-2 wheel-to-wheel battling it out. And, you know, those two started that way in Florida. It lasted through several races. And honestly, Rodney, the only time that we do not see those guys wheel to wheel, it seems, is Nick Davis has just had a plethora of issues this year. If you name it, he's broken it. You know, he's had some terrible setbacks. But aside from that, he's always right there with Jason Thomas battling for the win.
I'm still changing the
car. Hey, Rodney.
Yeah, go ahead, Matt Watson.
Hey, I'm down here in the pits with Timmy Wygan right now, Husky team manager. Got all kinds of stuff going on in your world. Josh Strang not here. Your man's coming in for a pit stop right now. Let us know what's going on.
Looks like he broke his throttle cable, so we're going to try to fix it real quick.
Just take a few minutes to pop a new cable in there. Josh Strang not here. You guys are as high as third place a minute ago. You're going to pop a little drink of gas in this thing right now. We'll go ahead and pull the cover off for you right there, let you give it a drink. So,
yeah, just trying to get as much stuff as we can done while we're in.
Awesome. Well, we're going to get out of your way, let you guys get this cable put back on there and get this guy back in the race. Back to you, Rodney.
Well, throttle cable, that explains a lot of it there, Johnny Gallagher. And that's an unfortunate incident for Andrew, but at the same time, if they can get it changed and him back out into this one, we might be surprised at what he can still do by the end of this race. We're only an hour now into the race, so about 2 hours left of racing. As we pointed out, not to hand out any trophies just yet, but just for fun's sake, yeah, we're having a lot of fun there about Ryan Sipes. But and I want to go back to that for just a moment. This is a great opportunity for Ryan Sipes. And though, yeah, you're right, it may not be a time to start handing out any trophies. Regardless of what happens with Ryan today, in my opinion, I think that what we're seeing is major strides in that program. And for him to be able to do what he did a couple of weeks ago in New York and to be able to come out here and do what he's doing, he's, if nothing else, testing the waters and see what works and what don't work. He's getting closer to the combination that he needs to actually be up here running up front and possibly taking those wins.
Well, you know, one thing we haven't talked about so far, you know, Rodney, the beauty about sitting in my seat is you're the main guy. You got to make all the intelligent comments. I could just play the devil's advocate. So you went ahead and were celebrating Ryan Sipes, so I went ahead and knocked you down. And now that you're say maybe he's just testing the waters, I'm going to go ahead and play the devil's advocate again. One thing that happened in New York is Caleb Russell was proven to be beatable. At this point, many people thought, you know, we had talked about, people at home had talked about, people on social media had speculated, perfect season, 13 for 13. It's going to happen. It's a foregone conclusion. Caleb admittedly said they missed their bike setup. He was a little bit off where he wanted to be. But what happened was someone else other than Caleb Russell won the race, that being Chris Bach and the JCR Honda team. Guy like Ryan Sipes, who's been there week in and week out chasing, and then always seems to have that little something that sets him back. Last weekend, or 2 weekends ago in New York, put himself on the box solidly in third for the first time this season. We saw him doing it at the end of last season, but really kind of came into his own so far this season. Now we're seeing him taking lead, and in the back of his mind, is the Caleb Russell enigma solved somewhat? Saying, hey, you know, Caleb Russell behind me, he's going to pass me, he's going to beat me. You know, my buddy Chris Bach may be upset with me for saying this, but at one point he actually told me, hey, it was no pressure for me because I was out there riding around, I was leading, but Caleb Russell was behind me. He was going to catch me, he was going to pass me, and I was just going to try and stay with him for as long as he could. And he didn't come, and he didn't come. So at that point, you have to start thinking, those guys, at least Bach, we're not putting him down, was thinking he couldn't beat Caleb Russell. Caleb Russell was going to catch him. Ryan Sipes now leading, certainly having Caleb Russell behind you is a force, it's a pressure. But at the same time, Ryan Sipes knows that Caleb Russell, at least on a day where he misses his setup, is beatable. So maybe in the back of his mind, he's thinking, I'm going to test Caleb's setup today. I'm going to make him push that factory FMF KTM as hard as he can and see if he can run with me today. And so far, Caleb's keeping him in check, but Ryan Sipes is making everybody give it everything they have.
Exactly, and good analogy on that, Johnny. I like the way you set that up, man. That is a great way to look at the whole situation and scenario that is unfolding before our very eyes right now as we continue to watch here now, an hour and 3 minutes into the race, about a minute or so before our leaders are due in at the finish line, and we should still be seeing Ryan Sipes in the number one spot in this one with Caleb Russell just a handful of seconds back. But if you remember from where we are now and the on the racetrack, we saw that Caleb was leading at one point the last lap, and then all of a sudden Ryan was out front there towards the end of the lap itself. So we'll see if maybe Caleb's got something up his sleeve here in this last little section of the track and try to put himself back in position to maybe get into the lead and then start extending things out there.
Yeah, you know, with these two guys out front, speed is certainly not something that is of shortage. These are possibly two of the most blazing fast riders on dirt bikes today in any discipline. Caleb Russell has proven that when he gets behind, we saw last year in Indiana, Caleb had a record-breaking get-off, subframe was bent, exhaust was torn off the machine. He was in the FMF factory KTM pits. People were speculating he was done for the day. He charged back, ended up on the podium in third place, and very, very, very nearly passed Thad Duvall in the last turn for second place. So we know Caleb has speed in bundles. We've seen him use it sparingly, but Ryan Sipes is a rider who, as we noted last year, in just a short break from GNCC Racing, went out, raced the Lucas Oil Motocross Series, had several top 10 rides, and then at the Ironman MX, the series finale, went out and landed on the podium with the best motocross riders in the world, which just 1 year earlier, Ryan Sipes was knee-deep in, stepped away from it, came back, proven he hadn't lost a tick as far as speed. He was right there with some of the best riders in the world. And speaking of the best riders in the world, the guy we just talked about made his charge back to the front. He must have heard us questioning his speed and questioning his dominance, and he wants to flex his muscle once again.
Well, you know, that was the kind of scenario we seen develop there last time. Caleb was out front. Ryan was in second. And then when they came back into that shot right there from the last time we saw them, it was flip-flop. And I wondered if maybe Caleb might have picked up on something that Ryan did, or maybe saw something, or figured out the mistake that he made through that section. And it looks like he most certainly did, as he is now back out front. But right literally on the rear wheel, less than two full bike lengths behind, is Ryan Sipes in the number two spot.
Yeah, you know, and Rodney, I got to tell you from experience, they're running the exact same track we ran yesterday with a few little sections added in, but nothing from the 7 to the 11 has changed. It's all the same. That is a gnarly section of race course, Rodney. You've got rocks. You've got slick rocks that are covered in moss and moisture, and then the black West Virginia dirt, almost said Georgia dirt, we're not in Georgia, the black West Virginia dirt gets up on top of those rocks, and it creates nothing short of some gnarly conditions. Looks like, by the way that berm exploded, we may have a new third place rider. We'll have to look and see, and yes, Grant Baylor, or is that, we'll have to wait and see if we can get a... Yes, Grant Baylor has taken over the third spot. Chris Bach hot on his heels. We've got a couple lap riders in the mix there. And these guys are hard on the gas, and we'll have to see what the split is. 52 seconds back from Ryan Sipes to Grant Baylor.
But he's turning. Yeah, by almost a 10-second faster lap time than what Ryan Sipes turned that last time around. And just 15 seconds, six seconds faster than Caleb Russell. As we said, that's 52-second gap. It is some momentum. It may be a still large gap and a lot larger than the what we're seeing that third place ride now race at. But the thing you got to remember is now that he has made it into third place, he has worked his way up through the pack into that spot, or at least fought and battled for that position with Chris Bach there. So he's now there. You got to wonder, we see this kid get faster as the race wears on. If he's this fast in the early part of the race and he continues to get faster, will he be able to maybe make this a three-way race at the end of this one? 52 seconds, though, is a lot of time to make up, even for the young Grant Baylor.
It is, you know, it's tough. The only thing I can say that with those three riders riding together, with Grant Baylor, Chris Bach, and Thad Duvall, we talked about Bach coming off a win, Thad Duvall in his home territory, home conditions he rides incredibly well, and in Grant Baylor with his late race strength, if anybody could put a package together to go after those dominant top two right now of Caleb Russell and Ryan Sipes, it would be those three. And, you know, we'll have to see exactly what they can do. And you know, we've heard in the past riders talking about working together on the podium. For those of you at home, it's not so much that they're actually communicating. It's just kind of an understood thing amongst racers. If one rider's feeling better in a certain section of the track, the other rider may move to the side, let them go by, because it's so much easier to follow. When you're just following that rear wheel, you don't have to do near as much thinking. You don't have to look ahead for braking bumps. You don't have to choose lines. You basically can just shut your brain off and react to what's happening in front of you. When you're the lead guy, when you're Caleb Russell in the lead, when you're Grant Baylor leading that train of three riders, you're the one that's reading the train. You're watching those lappers. You're choosing lines. You're doing everything that you can to try and make sure that you've got the best shot at making up time on the riders in front of you. When you're the caboose on that train, it's easy. All you do is follow. So right now, Ryan Sipes has the benefit of that. Chris Bach and Thad Duvall have the benefit of that behind Grant Baylor.
And look at this. As far as Chris Bach and Thad Duvall are concerned, look at how far they are behind Grant Baylor right now. If these three can stay together, you never know what can happen there. But Bach is only 2 seconds behind Baylor right now, as he'd just gotten around him. But Thad Duvall is only another 5 seconds back.
And here we see Andrew DeLong now working his way through at the completion of lap three. If we can get a refresher on our timing and scoring screen here in just a moment, we'll find out that he checks in, despite that, still inside the top 10 overall. So that was an incredibly fast throttle cable change for the Rockstar Husqvarna team those guys really got that machine fixed up quickly and him back out. So obviously disappointing to fall outside of a podium position, but to still be inside the top 10 overall, looks like he's probably going to get bumped back just a few spots with some XC2 riders checking in. Looks like that was, in fact, Tegan Temple and Jesse Grom as well on that factory beta. Now 10 and 11, bumping DeLong back to 12th overall, but still he is... Looks like he is our 6th, 7th, 8th place rider in XC1. So definitely, despite the fact that he had spent some time in the pits, very still much up in the mix on this one today. And we could very easily see him work his way back into a top five ride or maybe even to a podium contention.
An hour and 10 minutes now into this race here at the Mountaineer Run GNCC. It is Caleb Russell leading Ryan Sipes, Grant Baylor in third, Chris Bach in fourth, Thad Duvall in fifth, and we'll be back with more GNCC Live after this.
The Sunstar Work Z rear sprocket is made of stainless steel, making it three times more durable than a standard steel sprocket. Team it with the 520 XTG triple guard sealed ring chain with three lubrication pools per side. Durability in the toughest condition.
Introducing Slacker, the fastest, most accurate way to set your sag. Slacker is a digital sag scale based on measuring across the arc of the axle so you always get the right measurement. No more second guessing. See the measurements in real time. The remote display even allows single riders to easily take their own measurements. Unleash your bike's true potential with Slacker. Log on to motool.co now. That's motool.co.
Welcome back to GNCC Live as we continue an hour now and 13 minutes nearly into this Mountaineer Run GNCC. Rodney Tomlin, Johnny Gallagher along with Megawatt Matt Watson here with us. Just getting some reports and some news off the racetrack that there has been a slight course infraction and a penalty has been imposed on the number 9 of Chris Bach. He has been docked one position. Reason being, there are some corner markers and some white poles that are in some of these field sections, and for whatever reason, forced off the course and forced to the inside a little bit too much. Anyway, whatever the case may be, Chris did not make it around one of the inside white pole corner markers, so he will be penalized and docked one position. So a tough break for him there. He's got a hole to dig out of already, but nonetheless shouldn't affect his ride. Overall, himself personally on the racetrack today, it's just going to affect the results when it's all said and done. We come to the end of the day. So tough break there, but that's the way the GNCC rolls. And on occasion, folks inadvertently make some mistakes out there. And looks like Chris Bach might have been the victim of one of those. But right now, Caleb Russell still continuing to lead Ryan Sipes. And Grant Baylor back in the number three spot, about 52 seconds back. As Johnny Gallagher and myself talked about there a few moments ago, he was Baylor was running anywhere from a 6 to 10 second faster lap than Caleb Russell and Ryan Sipes ahead of him, with time still drawing to the nigh side of things here, you start doing the math, and it's still going to be kind of tough for Grant Baylor to make up that gap before the end of 3 hours. But we know that Baylor seemingly gets faster and faster as the race wears on. If if that's not the case for Russell and Sipes today, which could be a possibility considering how hard they're pushing each other, if it's not the case, then Baylor might be able to catch up with him, and he might bring Chris Bach and Thad DeBall right along with him as they're not far off pace with him. Joined in studio now by Megawatt Matt Watson. And Matt, Johnny heading out and about. I know he's got a couple things he's going to go check on. We'll probably be hearing from him here shortly. But I know you've been out and about yourself today. You've been over in the pro pits. You've been watching a couple of different sections of the track. What are you seeing out there right now?
Hey, the first thing I got to comment on is you talk about Sipes and Caleb being out front. And when two riders work up, a lot of things will happen. They'll either slow each other down or they will actually pick the pace up. And I can tell you, if we were talking about any two other riders, I might think that they would get into a bit of a battle and slow the pace. But I got to tell you, we know Sipes is an iron man, and we know Caleb's capabilities. And I want to tell you, I think it might be bad news now at this point for everybody else.
You're absolutely right. And the only saving grace for Grant Baylor right now is the fact that he does get faster as the race wears on. So that gap may not get as big as it could. But, yeah, there's so many unknown variables going on, especially we never had this scenario develop between these two riders in particular. And you've got a good analogy on that, Matt, because the intensity of both those riders, you're absolutely right. There is, I don't think it's a matter of they're going to be trying to key off each other and trying to bounce and maybe drive the other rider off the track. It's going to be a matter of speed that they're going to try to beat the other one with in some of these open field sections or outwitting them through some of those tight wood sections.
I know both these guys, Rodney. Okay, all right? These are men. These are guys that want to be that guy. There's no bumping and this and that. Doesn't need to be on this track. There's plenty of room to make a move. And I tell you, they're pushing each other right now to see who's going to last.
They're
pushing each other to see who's going to come out of here as a man. And let me ask you this. At one of the toughest races we've seen, New York, what did Ryan Sipes do?
He impressed.
Rose to the occasion, man. He's a tough guy.
He most certainly is. And that's one thing that he had told me the last couple of rounds in pre-race reports is that's the things he's been working on. You know, he took last year as a big learning curve for him, and he admits it. You know, it was a bigger learning curve and a lot more difficult to make the transition from motocross to GNCC and do it competitively than what he thought it was going to be. He said, you know, this is a program that I undertook myself. I'm a privateer. He says, I got a lot of great support from a lot of good people like Air Group, Husqvarna, Rockstar Energy, and things of that nature. He says, but this is my program. I built this team, and, you know, to do this, he goes, it was tough. It was hard, he said. And throw into that, the racing was a lot harder than what I expected it to be. He said it's all been worth it, though. You know, he says that now that he's got that year under his belt, and now we're another half season into it, and he's starting to find that flow and find that groove out there right now. He's getting a lot more comfortable, and I think that's translating into today. And you said a man, and who has got the best conditioning, that Ryan is pushing Caleb at this moment. And you're absolutely right. The big question, though, and Ryan will admit this as well, is that last not so much hour anymore in that three-hour race. It's now getting down to that last 45, 40 minutes now. So it's getting longer there that Ryan has been able to maintain that speed and his strength throughout that race. And 2 weeks, could that be another 40 minutes?
Hey, and on the flip side, Caleb Russell comes off the track at 3 hours, and he looks at me and says, man, front end wasn't sticking right. Wiping his face off and casual and got plenty in the tank. The guy looks at me and says, I couldn't get the rear end to settle.
Yeah.
At the end of 3 hours after winning, he couldn't get the end to settle or the rear end to settle? Okay. So let me tell you, you're talking about two of the most capable guys in warm conditions, rough conditions, physical conditions, showing why they're tough guys right now. Not discrediting any of the other riders
but they're
by any means. But I can tell you, when we talk about the two guys that are doing it, I see the pace picking up.
I do too. And it is picking up right now. We're watching right now and waiting on this clock. Last check, we're about 15 minutes now away from seeing this now fourth lap that these riders are on in completion. We're an hour and 19 minutes into the race, and that leaves us about...
All right, folks, we're out here this morning with our first winner of the day, Jet.
That wasn't me, I promise.
Megawatt, how did you do that?
I'm a ventriloquist. I can throw my voice.
Sounds like we got some action from earlier this morning. And that's one thing that we do want to point out. I guess now would be as good a time as any, Megawatt. Great racing action. It starts out each and every morning. Youth racing at 8 o'clock and 10 o'clock. And we have great racing at 10 o'clock as well. So, I mean, it kind of sets the stage for what we got right here this afternoon. XC1 and XC2 Pro and Pro Lights class with those A and B riders. And it kind of set the stage for what we're waiting with here at the 5-mile marker with bated breath. And we're talking about these leaders in this pro class. And can't wait to see what things are starting to shape up like. Is Caleb Russell still out front? And can Ryan Sipes keep the pace now as we approach the halfway point of the three-hour race here in West Virginia?
Well, I'm so excited to see that gap to third place.
Yeah.
I want to see what's happening right there, what these two guys are doing. And you know what? I want to see who's doing something about it behind him. I want to say, hey, I want a piece of that. I want to see who's back there going to step up and say, I need to be in that pack. I deserve to be right there.
Well, you got Chris Bach and both Thad Duvall. Now, again, Bach has been penalized because of a course infraction. But regardless, I mean, he can still be a factor in this race and push these guys to their limits.
Oh, absolutely. And I can tell you, it's probably motivation,
yeah,
Chris Bach right
because
now.
Because at this point, if he wants third, he's going to have to finish second.
Yeah, and I got a feeling he's going to let them know that the speed will make up the difference, not 20 or 30 feet.
Right.
So for sure. I'm sure that's on his mind right now.
Yep, and we're going to continue to watch here at the 5-mile marker. As we said, the pro should be coming through shortly. A lot of options coming into this mud line here. So we were talking with Johnny Gallagher about that. There's some hard base to it on the either side, but right down the middle it's soft and gushy and doesn't seem to have much of a base. And here we go. There's Caleb Russell. He's making his way through the 5-mile marker mud hole, and I do not see at the moment anyway Ryan Sipes. So the gap is starting to open up, and as we do approach that midway point here in this three-hour race, it looks as though maybe the war of attrition is starting to take its toll. It is a little warm today, but look at this coming in fast. I still think that's Ryan Sipes back there in that number two spot. We're going to put him at now 27 seconds that separate he and Caleb Russell at the 5-mile marker. So Caleb's really opened things up quite a bit here.
And in my mind, I'm going to call that a bad line or maybe a bit of traffic or something like that. I wouldn't think at this point right now, under 80 degrees temperature, that maybe it's a conditioning situation. I'd have to think that maybe Ryan has, you know, made a mistake.
Well, we got 220 riders out here on this race course today. So with that, that's that many more obstacles that a rider has to contend with and that many more opportunities to make wrong line choices due to lapped riders. Was that Grant Baylor, I think, going through there at the 5-mile marker? I didn't get a clock. And Chris Bach was right behind him on board the number 9. So like we said, Bach riding to ride a couple positions ahead at this point. The only thing is if he does get up front and take the win, he's still only going to get as good as second place today. So who's he going to have to pass to win? I guess he can't.
Yeah, that takes that out of the equation right there.
but
CV9 loaded with pride. Chris Bach 9. Ride now. He's a man possessed right now. He's got a point to prove.
He most certainly does. And Thad Duvall going by now, still in the number 5 spot. Looks like a bit of a gap opening up now between Bach and Thad Duvall back to the number 5 position. And this again at the 5-mile marker. Leaders due at the finish line in about 10 minutes and 40 seconds or so. And waiting and watching here at the 5-mile mud hole. That hole getting deeper on the, well, it'll be our TV right side, the track side left. But it's dry, but it's still getting deeper and deeper and deeper, and that's going to possibly make line choices a little more critical through there.
Yeah, Rodney, it's amazing to watch some of our amateur riders come through there, get a little huckabucka action going on through that deep hole as it gets deeper and deeper. And we watch Caleb and Chris and Baylor's come through there and just really right through the mud hole in about one half the time.
Yeah, and that's one thing that Johnny was pointing out there a few moments ago. Watch these guys pick their wheel up to go through this section while others are not. There's Jason Thomas now, your leader at the 5 mile mark in the XC2 Pro Lights class. And was that Nick Davis right behind him? I believe it was on that Rocky Mountain ATV MC Far Racing Husqvarna machine right there, that KR4 Arrive and Ride machine. Right there where he needs to be, right where he wants to be as far as in contention for the win. And we expected and anticipated this could be a possibility. Talking with Nick Davis earlier today in pre-race reports, he was telling me that, you know, being from PA and, you know, he's accustomed to these types of conditions like what we saw a couple of weeks ago in New York. And in reality, last year, his season didn't get started till this race. He was coming off of that, made the big switch. He started out with Obermeyer Suzuki in the early part of the year, and then he went kind of privateer for a couple of races, and then all of a sudden things just kind of switched around for him, and bam, he was right on the radar and has been ever since, and was picked up by the folks, obviously, at FAR, and they have helped manicure that rider's championships hopes in this XC2 Pro Lights. And though he's had a couple of off races, he was saying that he thinks might have been due to a toasted bike. His race bike got toasted in Georgia after those two great opening rounds that we saw he and Jason Thomas battling it out in. He said he's had problems since round three after that mud race, but today they got a fresh bike, and regardless of whether or not the bike had anything to do with it, Nick Davis felt a lot more confidence, and it's translating like that on the racetrack right now.
That program's on track right now, Rodney. They got all the pieces to the puzzle. They got them fitting together just about right now. But I can tell you, everything from management to equipment to mindset, mentality, physical fitness, those guys are a program that's on track.
They most certainly are, as Caleb Russell makes his way down through the pro pits now into the pit area, and you see Antti Kalanen is minus 26, minus 1 minute to Baylor, and looks like three laps to go is what they're saying.
Yeah, grab some fresh goggles, a splash of gas, no adjustments to the bike whatsoever, Rodney. Back out on the track and back up to race speed in under 30 seconds.
Well, there is Ryan Sipes checking in now, 27 seconds back, as he will go for a, did he go for a pit stop? I don't think he did.
No, he blew on by.
Yeah, he's at the other end. That's right. He's at the other end. They got the pits opposite way this week as they did last race, so that's why I'm a little confused. But regardless, I'm sure that he's going to be taking his pit stop right now. Less than 30 seconds still at pace with three laps or so left to go here in this race today. Still an impressive ride by the former motocrosser of Ryan Sipes right now, as he is really, helped elevate himself again here today. A lot of lessons learned up there riding at that pace with Caleb Russell. He knows what it's taking now. He knows the intensity that he's got to ride at. And that's also gearing him up to knowing how to train for this. Here's the funny thing. In talking with Ryan earlier today, he said, you know, I kind of got away from the motocross scene because of all the traveling and being away and having to train all the time and be on the road and so forth. And wanted to go to the GNCC where I could be home a little bit more. Well, there is one good thing about it. Yeah, you might be able to be home a little bit more, but I think he realized that training is going to be of the utmost necessity if he wants to be a contender.
You better believe it. He's figured that out by this part in the program. But you got to remember, that guy's rubbed fenders with Ricky Carmichael. He had James Stort put a knobby on the back of his boot more than once.
Yeah.
So he can handle the physical end of it. He can handle the mental end of it. And it's just a matter for him fine-tuning the program. He's built every program himself, Rodney. Every since the time he was an amateur and turned pro in motocross, everything he's done was because of Ryan Sipes. So he's a guy that figures out his own plan, and then he executes it.
Great way to do that, that's for sure. Out near the 7 mile marker right now, an hour and 28 minutes into this race, Caleb Russell continuing to lead. Ryan Sipes now about 27 and a half seconds back. And I don't know if Johnny Gallagher's ready with an update yet or not, but I know he's headed over to the pro pits. We'll get an update with him here in just a few moments.
Yep, Rodney, I'm actually here now in the JCR Honda pits with Johnny Campbell, team owner. They just had Chris Bach in here for a pit. We saw Caleb Russell come through with a little bit of a gap now on Ryan Sipes, as we saw on screen. Looks like Grant Baylor and Chris Bach reeling in Ryan Sipes now just a little bit, but we're here with Johnny Campbell. As you spoke about a few moments ago, we've got a pending penalty for Chris Bach, who missed a white corner marker on the backside of the pro pits. Johnny, it looks like they're going to issue a one position penalty as things stand right now. Your reaction to this?
Yeah, well, we'll accept the penalty right now during the race, but you know, it was clear on the course that it was marked improperly by them. They had to go back and remark the course.
So you're saying that the course markings have actually been changed since the initial marking. In speaking a moment ago, you said Chris actually came through, was battling with Thad Duvall. Thad was a little ways behind him. Positions were not exchanged. But again, you're accepting the penalty for now, but planning to pursue things further.
Yeah, we'll accept it now during the race. You know, but it was clear that the organizer was wrong because they went back and remarked the course at that point. We didn't make any positions. In fact, we actually last time in the whole thing that happened.
So there you have it, Rodney and Megawatt. We've got an update from Johnny Campbell. Sounds like they're not super pleased with the penalty, but accepting it for now, hoping to discuss it further or possibly appeal it in the future. But for the right now, it looks like Chris Bach is racing with a one position handicap as we complete this run here today.
Thank you a lot, Johnny Gallagher, and my tip of the hat to Johnny Campbell. Very cool, calm, and collected the approach to the whole scenario and situation. And, you know, I just gained a lot more respect out of that team right there.
That guy's a class act there, Johnny Campbell. That's Mr. Baja, as we all know. He's a great representative for Factory Honda. He's been associated with him. The guy's a diplomat. He knows what time it is, and he has the utmost respect for both the organization, the sport, and their competitors. And, yeah, his stock went up in my book a long time ago.
Well, there you go. So thanks a lot, Johnny Gallagher, for the update with JCR Honda team and Chris Box, mechanic and team manager there, Johnny Campbell. As we continue to watch here now, an hour and 30 minutes on working on an hour and 31 minutes into this race. Looks like out at the 7 mile marker, we're starting to witness some of our XC2 Pro Lights riders checking in. Again, looking a little further back after three laps of racing, working on lap four in the XC1 Pro class, Russell Sipes, Baylor, Bach, Duvall. Jordan Ashburn in sixth, Stu Baylor in seventh, Andrew DeLong is eighth, Chris Douglas in ninth, and Adam Barnor rounding out the top 10. XC2 Pro Lights, Jason Thomas and Nick Davis, 1.7 seconds.
Wow.
Man, that's the way it's been. Every time we see them on camera, they're right there nose to tail. Tegan Temple running in the number three position now. Tegan Temple, a minute and 32 seconds off the pace of what's going on right there. I think Matt Watson, that is a good explanation as to what kind of intensity those two riders are racing at now as well.
Let me tell you about early holiday fireworks right there. You get those two guys together and anything can happen. And I tell you, there's a classic example of those guys pushing each other away from the rest of the pack.
Most definitely. We're watching Austin Lee. The simple 1-2-3 of Austin Lee, as I always like to say, out of Bedford, Indiana. He's back in ninth place, part of the Yamaha team over there. And or is that Ricky Russell? Okay, it might have been. Okay, Ricky will be. That was Ricky. Austin Lee will be in next then. Ricky's actually running in the number five spot. Sorry about that. But regardless, a good Obermeyer Yamaha Reins Riding University team over there. Got the Atlas boys over there helping them out. That's a great organization that those two youngsters are racing in that XC2 Pro Lights class. More riders checking in the Pro Pits as we continue now with our Midway Report, the Mid-State Chevy Midway Report, as we work on lap number four right now for our XC1 and XC2 classes. Well, basically nearly all these classes, and after three laps of racing complete. Mid-State Chevrolet bringing you, well, all kinds of great, exciting news, and that is deep, deep savings. They stack them deep, they sell them cheap, and this weekend's Memorial Day sale is getting wild down there. You got to get down there, let them know you're part of the GNCC Racing Nation. They'll give you an even better deal than what you got already coming to you there as a part of their normal activities, but the GNCC Nation gets a little bit special deal. That's the home of your next new car, truck, or van, and the official truck provider of the GNCC Racing Nation. Thomas Davis, Tegan Temple back in the number three spot in this XC2 Pro Lights class. Jesse Grom in the number four spot. It is Ricky Russell we saw pitting there a moment ago in fifth. Lane Michael, the number 16, is in sixth. Craig DeLong running seventh. Trevor Bollinger is eighth aboard the 118. Austin Lee ninth. And Corey Butchick rounding out the top 10. Open A class, Zach Hayes in the number one spot there with a 39-second lead over Brandon Higgins, the 897. Hayes out of Sumter, South Carolina, with Colton, West Virginia being the home of Brandon Higgins. 846, Tommy Henderson out of Waynesburg, PA, a minute and 15 seconds back in the number three position. Fourth place, 740, Josh Brown out of Pittsburgh. Then we got, looks like Luke Ross rounding out the top five. There's Caleb Russell checking in at the finish line now as he wraps up lap number four, and he does this quite convincingly yet again. We'll pick back up with the update there in just a second. Russell turning a 28:45 lap time that time around. He actually slowed his pace down. That might be a saving grace for the young Grant Baylor if he's still racing at the intensity that we saw him racing at a little while ago.
No question about it. A lot of things can happen. If the pace continues to drop at a certain rate, yeah, that's really going to turn things around in a hurry.
Well, Antti Kalonen said that Baylor was a minute back, and 26 seconds back was that of Ryan Sipes when they checked in at the pit stop there at the 8-mile marker. After the conclusion of lap number four, Ryan Sipes is now 40 seconds back, a 29:24 lap time for him. And this is going to be the big question. Grant Baylor, is he able to make up ground? We'll continue with the Mid-State Chevy Midway report here in just a second there. As Baylor, we're going to get the lowdown on this from this NFAB AmPro Yamaha rider. And through the final few chicane turns there in the Amsoil finish region comes the 314 of the young rookie Grant Baylor, and 27.9 seconds at 28:59. Now he's about 30 seconds, 25 seconds faster than Sipes. In theory, by the end of this lap, he should be within a couple of seconds, but still running about 10 or 15 seconds slower, about 14 seconds slower than Caleb Russell that last time around. We'll continue now with our Mid-State Chevy Midway report with our Open A class. Zach Hayes, Brandon Higgins, Tommy Henderson, Josh Brown, and Luke Ross, as we were telling you there a moment ago. The 250A class sees Anthony Stone, the 552 out of Reidsville, West Virginia, a minute and 47-second lead over Mark Horesco, the 412 out of Pittsburgh. The number 50, Mason Atherton, another 47 seconds back out of Clarion, PA. In fourth place is the 824 of Thorne Devlin out of Tamaqua, Pennsylvania, and the 330 of Vance Francis out of Bonnieman, Kentucky, rounds out the top five. 200A class only got four of those guys that completed at the three laps. Actually, only I think we had like five or six, so somebody must have had some struggles on that first lap. But Chris Vendetti, who got the whole shot in that class, the 101 from Fort Mill, South Carolina, a 6 minute and 4 second lead. 339 Clint Masters running second out of Morgantown, West Virginia. Logan Lowry, the 362 out of Trenton, Missouri, is third, and Zachary Ferrance rounds out fourth. Four-stroke eight lines, Tyler Braniff out of Terre Haute, West Virginia, only the 4.5 second lead over Jake Froman, the 862 in second. The 100 of Joshua Lee, Statesboro, Georgia, is in third. Braxton McGee, the 45 from Bowlerville, North Carolina, is fourth. And the 704 Tristan Landrum out of Nelsonville, Ohio, rounds out the top five. Something to point out, Landrum a lot of times and oftentimes grabs the hole shot in that class and oftentimes takes the win, seeing him back in the number five spot. A little out of the ordinary, at least for me. Junior AB 25-plus class, Jedediah Haynes leading there out of Fairfield, PA, after three. Aaron Cox in the 430 out of New Cumberland, West Virginia, is second. 5 minutes, 27 seconds back. It is Joseph McCarty, the 44, another 4:58 back out of Mount Clair, West Virginia. Fourth place, 4:16, Kyle Iser from Erie, PA, 2 minutes and 31 seconds back. And rounding out the top five, 7:17, Brandon LaDon from Allison Park, PA. Wow, what a lot of deficit there in between each one of those positions in that junior 25-plus class. Continuing next, the Vet A 30-plus class, the 35, Joe Marsh out of Pittsburgh, PA, a minute and 1 second over Jesse Arsenal out of Coventry, Connecticut. The 409, Logan Mills from McDonald, Ohio. He's third. Fourth place is the 801, Tom Trucks out of Verona, PA. And rounding out the top five, it's Big Jim Steiner. Big Jim out of Van Etten, New York, on an Ithaca Recreation Power Sports back machine. And I tell you, a good buddy of mine from up out of the Winoa series, Big Jim is all of about 5'7", man, and he is a powerhouse, dude. I mean to tell you, this man is a man's man, no doubt about it. He is dynamite in a small package, but he might be a little not so tall, but he's not a small man. He is built to the hilt, let me tell you. And, you know, it's really cool. I've seen him in years past. He used to race with his son in the Open A class. What was that? You know what? I was accused of a man crush. No, I am impressed by this guy. He's about the same age as I am, and amazing physical condition is exactly what we're talking about out of big
puts
gym.
Puts me in the mind of John Martin, Alex yeah. Martin's dad.
Out of Millville.
Won a National Enduro Championship. The guy about 5'6" and rode an ATK 406 that came up to his neck to a championship.
No doubt. Big Jim, actually, in years past, up until last year, was racing the Open A class with Little Jim, who's a little bit bigger than him, believe it or not, and height-wise. But Jim went ahead and Big Jim decided to race the vet class this year. So good for him. He could be racing the Senior A class, but he's racing in the 30-plus A. Right now, the Senior A 40-plus class has a former top GNCC star, Dwayne Connor, out of Houston, PA. The 154
Absolutely.
Leading there, a minute and 28 seconds over Patrick Davis. You remember Dwayne. I mean, he was a big icon and name in this sport.
Absolutely. I've been friends with Dwayne for years. Big supporter of his over the years. Always cheered for him. Local guy. And once again, talk about tough guys there. There's one for you.
Yep, and Patrick Davis, another tough guy, back in the number two spot, a minute and 28 seconds back out of Martinsburg, West Virginia. Billy Schlag, man, who caused all kinds of ruckus there in that first turn. I don't know if you caught that first the start of this race, man, but it got crazy up there for a minute, and Schlag was just all over the place. Looked like he was bouncing around like a ping pong ball or a pinball in there, and about took a few people out, but they all got it straightened out. But he's up to third now to Mechanicsville, Maryland. The 452 of Edgar Davis out of Tazewell, Virginia is fourth, and old shotgun Sean Remington, the 47 machine out of New Salem, PA's back in fifth, and kind of expected to see him up a little further, but I know that when
Dwayne, not over, bro.
No, it's not. And when Dwayne Remington.
Yeah, come on.
Yeah, he's gunning for a little better spot than what he's got going on right now.
Oh, I get it. Remington, he's gunning for it, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, he brought a Magnum load today.
Okay. I call him Shotgun, by the way.
Okay.
Hey, Tyler Anderson leading the Open B class out of Myersdale, Pennsylvania, at the 67, a minute and 24 seconds over the 575 of Chris Bartone from Athens, Ohio. 290 Bill Savendi out of Cabot, PA is running third. The 519 Ryan McManus from Nelsonville, Ohio is fourth. George Shell, though, at 7'10", out of Sure, West Virginia, rounds out your top five. 250 B class now, Brewer Carlily, the 6'14", from Lexington, South Carolina, leading the 225 of Mike Miller out of Fairmont, West Virginia, by a minute and 47 seconds. Another 255 back in the number three spots, the 995 of Noah March from Frostburg, Maryland, with the 403 of Kobe Beckert out of Zanesville, Ohio, in the number four spot. Evan Schultz, the 375 out of Cannonsburg, PA, rounding out the top five, only 3 seconds behind Beckert for fourth right now. 200 B class, Cameron Sisk from Morganton, North Carolina, 17 seconds back. Jake Ross, this is a tight race. The 392 of Ross out of Middletown, Virginia, is running that number two spot, and should be exciting to watch. I think, honestly, that maybe Ross had the lead and Sisk passed him. If you look at lap time, Sisk had a 37.04 that last time and a 37.41 for Ross, and there was only 17 and a half seconds separating the two. That's about half the difference in the lap time, so I'd say that maybe a pit stop that time around for Ross gave Sisk an opportunity to move ahead. Matt Bruffy, the 369 West and West Virginia, in third place. The 105 Zachary Hugo out of Seneca, PA, is fourth. And Colton Cup, the 425 out of Morgantown, West Virginia, rounds out the top five. Four-stroke B lights class, the 283 of Trey Jefferson from Westminster, South Carolina, 1 minute, 2 second lead over the 911 of Daniel Spurgeon out of Bowling Green, Kentucky. 405 Michael Tetlow at 11 in Junction, Kentucky, a minute and 35 seconds back in third. Alex Ankrum, the 764 from Hamden, Ohio. That's in just north of me, actually. He's running in fourth. And Drew Bolton, the 517 out of Mooresville, North Carolina, rounds out your top five. It's pretty neat. A lot of Southern Ohio riders around the area, including leader of this class right here, the Vet B30-plus class, Nelsonville, Ohio's Jeremy Dexter, the 880, a 3 minute, 27 second lead over the 919 of Scott Dallin out of Waynesburg, PA. Carnegie, PA is home to the third place ride, the 388 of Timothy Nethkin. Then we got fourth place, the 364. That is Mike Udovic out of Rice's Landing, PA, and Mark Yukovich out of Washington, PA. The 466 rounds out the top five. Senior B40-plus class, Charlie Altimus got the whole shot in that one, still leading now, only 3.5 seconds. I think that's the tightest race on the track right now for the lead. Robert Cornish, the number 411, out of Pemberton, New Jersey, is third. Scott Campbell, the 130, out of Sissonville, West Virginia, is fourth. And Mike Beckett, the 456, rounds out the top five out of Maysfield, Georgia. And that is your Mid-State Chevy Midway report here as three laps and now four laps complete for a majority or a good number of our riders out there, including Ryan Sipes, Caleb Russell, who's leading Ryan Sipes by 40 seconds. Grant Baylor running in the number three spot, another 27 seconds back. Chris Bach is fourth. Thad Duvall rounds out your top five, and we'll continue with more GNCC Live right here on RacerTV.com after this.
Any engine, any season, at home, at the track, or on the trail, AMSOIL for any engine.
The SunStar WorkZ rear sprocket is made of stainless steel, making it three times more durable than a standard steel sprocket. Team it with the 520 XTG triple guard sealed ring chain with three lubrication pools per side. Durability in the toughest condition. Scott's Performance, the only steering dampener with 21 Baja 1000 overall victories, introduces the new Scott's Rubber Submount. Easy to install at less than an hour in most cases, it features adjustable on-the-fly dampening to help reduce arm pump and fatigue. Come see what 25 years of experience building the best stabilizer can do at scottsonline.com.
Do you love racing? All kinds of racing? How about pro motocross, flat track, road race, ATV, GNCC, Supermoto, Enduro Cross? Well, we've got what you're looking for. Welcome to the Racer X Show with Greg White, presented by Chaparral Motorsports. New every Tuesday on RacerTV.com.
This Racer TV Live broadcast is brought to you by AMSOIL, the first in synthetics. By Rocky Mountain ATV MC, get ready. By Maxxis Tires, find your flow. And powered by Yamaha Generators.
And welcome back to GNCC Live. Rodney Tom along with Matt Watson. Johnny Gallagher out and about with us today as well, as we're now looking at an hour and 46 minutes into this race. Caleb Russell continuing to lead Ryan Sipes, Grant Baylor in third, Chris Bach in fourth, and Thad Duvall back in the number five spot. The Rocky Mountain ATVMC.com Mountaineer Run GNCC from Masontown, West Virginia, high atop Marvin's Mountaintop and overlooking the heartland of GNCC Racing, as well as only moments away from the home offices of Racer Production. And don't forget, folks, if you haven't done so yet, make sure you get involved in our Twitter contest here today, as we have the possibility for you to win $250 in AMSOIL product. All you got to do is tweet your podium finish predictions to hashtag GNCC Live for a chance to win that $250 in products, and we will choose the winner randomly. Be done toward the end of the show. You don't have to be right, but you got to hashtag GNCC Live in order to play.
Yeah, I don't think I'm hanging too good right now. I've got number one nailed down. That was a pretty easy one there.
But, yeah. you know, I have to, that's a good one. If you would have talked to me coming into this race today and asked me, what do you think the podium's going to shape up like? In reality, this is what I would have told you. Caleb Russell, I think he's gonna bounce back and rebound back from what happened in New York a couple of weeks ago, and I think he's gonna do it quite convincingly. And that was what I said when we left the facility there a couple of weeks ago New York. He had a mission that he was gonna be on. I also had an idea and a likelihood that I thought that Grant Baylor was going to do well here today, and seemingly so far has done just that. And my third pick on the podium would have been Thad Duvall. Several different reasons. One of the reasons maybe why I would have shied away from it would be because of the incident at the last round of racing with a dislocated hip and things of that nature. But I was banking on the momentum of the hometown crowd maybe helping him rise above that, and it still may before the checkers fly on this. But I would have chosen Russell, Baylor, and Duvall, believe it or not, if I was choosing my overall three. So I would have been a little off pace, I think.
Yeah, you know, and that's a logical call to me, without question. It's just when Johnny put me on the spot, I come up with Caleb, Thad, and Chris Bach as how I saw it. But as you can see, anything can and will happen in GNCC racing. And,
it most certainly will.
Let me tell you something. We're only an hour and 48 minutes into this thing.
Yeah, exactly.
There's plenty of time left on our extremely rough Marvin's Mountaintop Mountaineer Run course.
You're absolutely right there, Megawatt, and I have to tend to agree with that. There's still a number of things that can happen, and we could, in an hour and 10 minutes, be sitting here with our mouths dropped down on the floor trying to pick them up just at what we may have just witnessed. And that's the great and exciting thing, I think, about GNCC. You never know what's going to happen from one turn to the next, one wood section to the next, one field section to the next. Anything can happen. We've seen it happen already with Caleb and Ryan earlier when they kept swapping positions back between that, say, 8-9 mile marker to the 11-mile marker.
Yesterday, Michael Swift, fourth to first on the last lap, 4x4 pro win.
Yep, so that goes to show you a whole lot, and it proves a whole lot. You know, right now, with this 5-mile marker we're watching, again, you know, you got to wonder what the rest of the course is shaping up like. But with talking with Johnny, there are a few of these little types of sections out there. They got good hard bottoms in them, but not a lot of people getting stuck out there, I don't think. So that's one good bit of news that we can say about that. And at the same time, it gives them all a bunch of variety. There's Caleb Russell making his way in now here at the 5-mile marker.
You notice Caleb's style when he come through there. Stayed on the rear of the bike, kept the power on a little bit. Front wheel just barely skimmed that section, while the amateur rider beside him took the rougher line, looked like he was riding a buck and bull. Growing up in this area, it was always a safe bet to me that it was solid under that mud.
Yeah.
You know, keep the gas on, keep that front wheel high. If that front wheel's not down in that big hole or not down in that rut, the only thing you can do is go forward.
There you go. And that's a good way to point it out and to approach it in most circumstances, in most cases, especially like you say in this terrain. It may be a little soft on top, but normally there's a rock or something down there that hardens it up for you.
Hey, man, when we were kids, you learned to get through that, or you just picked up another hobby, I can tell you.
Well, that right there was part of the fun of it for me when I rode,
sir,
as a kid. You know, I mean,
absolutely,
I never did race competitively or anything, but I rode the wheels off my motorcycle, and I look for places like that. I'm not going to lie to you.
You bet.
The deeper I could bury it, the happier I'd be. And here comes Sipes in now, I believe. And whoa, is Zank starting up? That looks like Baylor maybe has pulled up now into. Yep, that is the case. And they're a minute now, about a minute and 10 seconds behind. Looks like Caleb Russell, who's in first. But what we do see is Grant Baylor and Ryan Sipes now have hooked up. And there comes Chris Bach now, the number four position, which should put only 30 seconds or so back now, Thad Duvall. And this is going to be a good question as to whether or not Thad is making up any time here late in the race, because we see that Bach is seemingly staying pretty consistent behind Grant Baylor right now. That looked to be within that 10-second range. He was actually about 8 seconds behind at the end of lap number four, so I don't think Bach has lost any time. And, you know, looking at it right now physically on the track, he may have an opportunity to take a second-place position here today.
Rodney, you hit the nail on the head a minute ago when you talked about lap time versus deficit. The difference in the lap time versus the difference in the deficit was going to result in this, and here it is. And actually, Grant's picked it up a bit since you've said that. So now he's up there going to make that move, I'm sure, any time on Sipes. He's fresh and he's ready to go. And consequently, also, we said Bach was going to get up there and ride at the same pace as these guys, especially after that infraction, and that's exactly what he's doing.
Well, we saw Duvall just go by, and it looks like it's a little more than that 32-second frame that we were talking about. So we're probably looking more about 45 or 50 seconds. And looking at lap times, I think that Thad Duvall, with these conditions, and he'd even mentioned, you know, with a dislocated hip, he said, you know, I don't have a lot of problems at home because, you know, I feel good and everything because I know where to put my foot down and where to dab the ground and where not to. He said, out here, I'm not so familiar with this racetrack, so a lot of it's going to hinge on whether or not he rides strongly today. as to whether or not how much problems the hip that he dislocated a couple weeks ago is going to give him. And I'm not saying that it's given him any problems, but I'm also not saying that it's not sore and probably not keeping him at bay just a little bit today.
Yeah, Chad told me they laid him down on the trailer. You know, he was feeling pretty sore with his back and all, feeling pretty sore. But they laid him down on the trailer, and he said, my leg. And when they pulled the hip from him, said it actually flexed the trailer when they reset the hip.
Wow.
For him. And said that was the most pain he'd ever really ever seen him in, but he was feeling better pretty soon after that.
Well, there goes another of our XC1 Pro Class riders through there just a moment ago. So I think that was Nick Davis. That's what I was looking at. I was thinking, man, that looked like one of the Husqvarnas, but it looks like maybe Nick Davis might have taken over the number one spot away from the 17 of Jason Thomas, and wouldn't be surprising to me to have had that happen. There is that Thomas there? No, that's Russell. I'm sorry. Russell out by the 7 mile marker. That white background kind of got me a little bit confused there, but again, remember, Russell does run the white background with a red number. Again, that reversal of the number plate signifying the championship points lead at this point in round seven. So we know that Russell is at least a minute or so ahead of that battle for second place, which is now Ryan Sipes and Grant Baylor. And it's another good test for Ryan Sipes right now.
No question. It's going to be a testament to his adaptability and his fitness, without question, being able to make that adjustment here. Now he's got a different strategy. Now he's got a different position on the track that he has to defend. And we're going to see what the technique, or actually what the strategy is right now and what he's able to do with it.
Russell heading through the pro pits right now as they dump a little water on the back. And no real commotion over there in the pro pits. A little, looks like pit board action going on for him. But other than that, it's just a matter of they're waiting to see what's going on as we check back in out here at the 7 mile mark. I believe we'll be seeing those. There is Jason Thomas. We saw Nick Davis go through there just a moment ago, and it looks like he is changing rear wheel. And here's the important thing. Look at what's going on. Jason Thomas is the only one in those pits. He's a one-man band, a one-man show, believe it or not. The only person that travels to the races as of late with Jason Thomas is his little dog. And it's a little lap dog, but look at this. Some of the GNCC guys are stepping in. They're going to come back over, and they're going to try to help him out.
There's Casey Greek over there in the mix, and looks like we got a couple different guys, like you said, from other camps jumping in to help get him back on the course as quick as possible.
Man, that's tough. I mean, he's got to gas himself. He's got to do his own mechanical work and things like that. He's got to get his tools ready. I mean, nothing was ready for this little change that he's got going on when he came into the pit, so what a tough way to go there for Jason Thomas. But, man, you know, at the same time, you almost got to respect Jason for being able to make things happen as well as he has so far, being a one-man show.
No doubt he wants it. Okay,
yeah.
The determination and desire is there. And you know what? We all have our opinions of every situation, but that guy wants it.
He most certainly does. And we're going to watch, see what happens. Casey's getting in there. He's kind of overwatching what's going on, overlooking, I should say, what's going on. But there are folks that are beginning to lend hands there, and that goes to show you, again, the camaraderie. And we do have his mechanic finally back in there. So not much of a one-man show, but Jason does do a lot of this all by himself, and this guy comes and does help out as much as he can. So he gets in there, and he's finally got a little bit of assistance going on there now.
Frustration starting to sit in right now. You see him slap his helmet a minute ago, you know, shake his head just a bit, and understandably so.
Yes, most certainly understandably so, because he's looking at that race win slipping away from him. I think if you look at the points, that shouldn't be much of a factor, as he's had and enjoyed a rather commanding presence in the XC2 Pro Lights here in 2015, and he's been literally the most consistent, I think, of all these guys. If you look at the finishes through the first six rounds, and he's got a little bit of a buffer zone between himself and the number two spot. So as frustrating as it is, even if Nick Davis does take a win today, it's not going to threaten that championship points lead so much for Jason. But what it is going to do, it's going to get Nick Davis back into the game. He said he's back in fifth place in points right now, and he's hoping to at least be able to claw his way back up into a top three by the end of the championship season here for 2015.
I'm not exactly what I saw right there when he was leaving the pits.
What happened?
I saw him go underneath the banners and head back out. I'm not sure exactly where he was planning on entering the course.
Well, he left the track left the track around the 5 mile marker. So what's going to happen
exactly.
is he's going to go back to where he left the track. And for those of you watching at home not familiar with that, you are allowed to leave the course in GNCC racing. Here he is re-entering the racetrack at the 5 mile marker. So hats off to Jason Thomas. He didn't gain any advantages by doing that, but that is allowed. If you exit the race course, and we talk about that, it's in the rules. We talk about it in the riders briefing meeting and safety meeting there, and we tell you if you leave the course for any reason, you must re-enter where you left, and that's exactly what Jason Thomas just did. Perfect execution of the rules right there.
Yeah, I saw him come sliding into the pits. I just thought he was waiting to make the repair when he got there, so.
Now, sometimes they have to force it. I know that's not what Jason wanted to do, but probably, if you think about it, 3 miles would have been a long row to hoe for him in the condition that he was trying to ride in. And if you look at where he left the race course at and to where he was, it was less than a half mile rather than 3 miles, so it worked out a little better for him.
You bet. About 2 hour mark right now, Rodney, getting down to that stretch. Going to start being ready to see a white flag here pretty soon.
Yep, and as we update the situation, 3 minutes and 15 seconds before we'll be seeing Caleb Russell checking in. 40 seconds was the gap at last lap around. We were a minute and 10 seconds at the gap between first and second with Sipes and Baylor battling for the number two spot. The last time we caught up with these guys on camera, Chris Bach was still running in fourth. Duvall was still back in the number five position. Nick Davis was running now sixth place overall and was leading the XC2 Pro Lights class. There goes Thomas by the 7 mile marker now, so you can see. Oh, that looked like Thomas, but my eyes were deceiving me there.
Yeah, I thought that was Jason.
I believe that was might have been Tegan Temple back there. Jesse Grom, I believe, they're battling it out for the number 10 spot right now. So that's what we're watching there as they went by there at that 7 mile mark here. At now just over 2 hours into this near 3 hour race at the Rocky Mountain ATVMC.com Mountaineer Run GNCC. Caleb Russell on a mission today. You know, someone asked me and posed the question, and there's that battle right there, I guess, or was it? Grom deciding to pit on this one, so Temple will take over the number 10 spot in the overall right now, and that is the battle for the third place position now, and actually that was the third place position, but since Thomas is now out, that would make it the battle for the second place spot, so no wonder that in the intensity that we're watching in that XC2 Pro Lights podium race is getting so intense, and again, that was also for 10th overall as much as second place in class, and you got to wonder at this point which is more important. I think those boys want on the podium, but they also like the fact that they can score overall top 10 points too.
Oh, no question. That's definitely on their mind right now. But here we go, the late stages of the race, just about an hour to go. Already starting to see some things come into play right now, already seeing some decisions starting to play out on the track.
Most certainly. And right now at the conclusion of this near now five laps, you got to wonder, how much different is it going to be? And I would I have to wonder also, are we going to see a two-lap board come out on this one? I think we will.
I would have to think so.
So a seven-lap race. They're wrapping up lap five. They'll get the white flag for lap six and the checkers at the end of lap seven. It'll be an intense one. You know, we said it a few minutes ago. At the end of an hour and 10 minutes, we could be sitting here with our mouths wide open, and I believe that the stage is still setting for something like that right now as we speak.
Yeah, I think with Jason Thomas making his way past that mile marker number seven right now, back on the gas, back up to speed right now, back in the race, you know, that guy, he's going to do everything he can to pick up every piece of real estate between him and the guys ahead of him right now.
Caleb Russell right on the money as far as getting into the finish line when expected. Actually, I might have slowed the pace down just a little bit. We'll have to check. But a 28:45 lap time last time around for him. Two lap board is out, and Caleb Russell will be taking that now as he wraps up mile number 11 on lap number five. And a 28:45 lap time on lap four. And as far as lap five is concerned, we'll get that lap time for you. Right now, as a matter of fact, looks like a 28:55. So he did slow down about 10 seconds. That's what I was expecting there with my scoring and timing computer, but oftentimes it's a little different, and I have to wait to get the exactness out of it. But wow, Caleb Russell now, as we said, a minute and 10 seconds, maybe even 12 seconds ahead of second place. Here's where it's going to get exciting. When we come around for this battle for second place, you've got the young Grant Baylor, and you've also got Ryan Sipes that should be pretty much nose to tail, if any indication of what we saw there a little bit ago. And here comes, is that Sipes? No, they're not nose to tail. They are not nose to tail now. They're
Baylor so, just passed, as a matter of fact. He came front ahead of him.
Grabbing Mike, I believe that Johnny Gallagher's got an update. Either I might have misspoke, or what's going on, Johnny?
Rodney, I was just out at the 8.5 mile marker. We were trying to film a stand up there, and what I saw was Grant Baylor come through with two badly damaged and bent handguards, quite a bit behind Chris Bach, who is now in the third place spot. So we've had a big shakeup there. We will be waiting on Chris Bach, not Grant Baylor. And I'm going to head over to the Ampro pits and see if I can get an update on Baylor when he comes through. Here is Chris Bach working his way through now to the finish. Take a look at Grant Baylor's handguards when he comes through. He's got one bent way up, one bent way down, both of them damaged badly and disconnected. So he's obviously had one heck of a crash or impacts with trees out there somewhere.
Yeah, something certainly has happened, and it is hampered his advancement and that battle for second place. And here he comes now on screen. You see him rolling through, and yeah, man, looks like he took some shots. So tough break there for Grant Baylor, but you know, you got to wonder with the two lap board out whether or not maybe he might be able to adjust to the situation and still be able to salvage a little more out of this right now.
Yeah, it looks like he's going to have to make some decisions. Which way are we going to go with it right now? Are we going to push as hard as we can? Are we going to try to pick something up? Or are we going to settle into a pace and ride it out?
Now, you know, it's a wild card, I think, really, with Grant Baylor right now. You could say the mature Grant Baylor would say, let's ride this out. Let's salvage what we can out of this day. And the heart attack Grant Baylor would be all throttle, man. And I mean that with all the respect in the world. I don't mean it as he's riding loosely or over his head by any stretch of the imagination. Just mean he is a very intense rider, especially toward the end of the race. And when he's had a deficit, he seems to dig that much deeper. And we've seen that out of his big brother, Stu, over the years as well. So, you know, it could be, it's a 50-50 guess right here, right now. Depends on just
it depends what? On the damage under those handguards.
You're absolutely right.
Okay.
That's the biggest.
Let me tell you something. If that throttle's not working right, if that front brake is sticking, if that clutch is hitting or it's stuck up against that handguard, that's going to make a decision how much damage is done to that bike.
I think you're absolutely right, and that's going to make the decision on whether or not Grant is going to be able to make those remarkable pushes that he makes. Right now, we are 2 hours and 6.5 minutes into this race, and you know, Matt, next race we go to the John Penton GNCC, one of the longest standing GNCCs on the circuit now. And then after that, we go to Snowshoe, the granddaddy of them all, so to speak, or what has become a granddaddy of them all, our tribute to the granddaddy, the Blackwater 100, as we celebrate 41 years of GNCC racing and the first ever Blackwater. There is the number three machine making his way in now. Here at the finish line, that's Jordan Ashburn. That is eighth place. So we got Russell Sipes, Bach, Grant Baylor is fourth, Thad Duvall is fifth. Jason Thomas is, let's scratch that. Let's go to the XC1. And actually, Thomas is not in the top 10 now as he had some issues and had to have that fixed. But Thad Duvall is fifth, Jordan Ashburn sixth in class, Stu Baylor seventh, Andrew DeLong in eighth, Chris Douglas ninth, and Adam Manure in 10th. As far as the overall goes, I would say Nick Davis is sixth. Jordan Ashburn is in the number seven spot. Then I'm going to say Stu Baylor is number eight overall. Jesse Grome, ninth overall. And Andrew DeLong then would be 10th overall. Unofficially, of course, there's Stu Baylor checking in now at the finish line. It will be for the, looks like, XC1 Pro Class. Seventh place position for that rider now. 29:51 lap time. He's a full minute off the pace of Caleb Russell's last lap time. So two laps to go in this one, and we are at about 2 hours and 8 minutes exactly now into the race. Still Big question of who's who and what's going to happen here today and who's going to make it happen. We've seen a lot of changes take place throughout the course of this race, and we've got an hour's worth to go still. So stick around. We'll see what happens when it all ends here on Marvin's Mountaintop as GNCC Live.
Scott's Performance, the only steering dampener with 21 Baja 1000 overall victories, introduces the new Scott's Rubber Submount. Easy to install at less than an hour in most cases, it features adjustable on-the-fly dampening to help reduce arm pump and fatigue. Come see what 25 years of experience building the best stabilizer can do at scottsonline.com. The Sunstar Work-Z rear sprocket is made of stainless steel, making it three times more durable than a standard steel sprocket. Team it with the 520 XTG triple guard sealed ring chain with three lubrication pools per side. Durability in the toughest conditions.
Welcome back to GNCC Live. Johnny Gallagher with an update from the NFAB and Pro Yamaha pits.
Yeah, exactly, Rodney. You're here with Corey McDonald, mechanic for Grant Baylor. Looks like he's had some troubles out there. We see the handguards badly mangled. Looks like you've got some tools, and we're going to get you out of here quick because you got to get to the six-mile marker. You're making some repairs. What's going on out there, Corey?
Yeah, right before he came through the pits of the last lap, he took a pretty good digger and broke his bark busters and tweaked his front end. He came in, strained his front end back out, and trying to get back out there.
All right, there you have it, folks. He's heading out. You can see he's got tools in hand, and he's on his way to go get Grant fixed up. So we'll see if Grant can charge back up into a podium spot as he's just a few seconds behind Chris Bach.
All right, thanks a lot, Johnny Gallagher. Good update there, and it's good to know what's going on there. And that's exactly what Grant's going to need. They'll get that strained around, and we might see Baylor actually pick that pace back up and see some pretty exciting stuff out of him before the check. And that might be our jaw-dropping moment that we're talking about, too.
It could be. Hey, you notice Gallagher looked like he could work for Access Hollywood.
Yeah.
You know, huh?
Yeah, he looks good,
man.
Got a found his niche, I think, in TV, to be honest with you. And we got 2 hours and 11 minutes. I just thought about that. You remember Video Killed the Radio Star? I've got a face for radio. We all already figured
that
out.
That makes two of us, I can guarantee you.
You know, it's... We watch this all unfold right now, and being here in the homeland, in the heartland of GNCC racing, it all brings me back to where it all began. And you know, and I can't help but think about the youth racing that began it all out this morning. Matt Watson, I know you had a chance to catch up with our winner, Jesse Ansley, from that 8 o'clock youth race.
All right, folks, right here this morning with our first winner of the day, Jesse Ansley, taking our youth overall win today. Jesse almost made it look easy as usual, but, man, there was quite a race going on behind you.
Yeah, it was a tough race for sure. I don't know what happened on the start. My bike wouldn't start in gear like we've been doing, but I just dealt with it. I put it back in neutral, kicked it, and luckily Chase was got a bad start too, so I just latched onto him. We came up through the pack, and then we got up to fourth, I think, and we weren't too far behind the leaders, and then I passed Chase because I knew that I had more in me and I just needed to go and get up front, so I passed him, and then I think the second lap, I don't know what happened, a light switch came on and I just was on rails, and I caught Connor on the ground, and I caught Hunter, and I rode for him about a mile, and I eventually passed him and just put my head down and just kept on charging.
Well, we've seen you flip that switch before, and this is normally the result when that happens, man. Hey, tell us a little bit about this mountaintop track here today.
For the Florida boy, it's pretty difficult. It's a lot of rock for sure. It's really technical, and I think the fastest guy won't win. It just have to be, you have to be smart, you have to be smooth, and it takes a lot to put the win together here.
And no mistakes.
Yes, for sure.
All right, hey, who's the short list of sponsors you want to thank here?
I'd like to thank my grandpa, man. He sacrificed his life for me to chase my dream, and hopefully I'm making him proud, and you know, getting the win, he deserves a win, and I'm trying to get it for him, and Action KTM, the Hilo, FMF, just I have a bunch, but I don't want to, you know, I forgot my list.
Awesome. Well, we'll see you up on the podium, and we'll finish that list.
Thank you.
Great job. And back to you guys in the studio.
All right. Welcome. Thanks a lot, Mac Watson. And we'll also be checking in here shortly with the WXC winner, Casey Martinez, shortly as well as we add another great battle. That was youth racing at 8 o'clock, and at 10 o'clock this morning we also had, I think it was, about 375 riders on the racetrack this morning. Pretty impressive stuff, to say the least, and the women's WXC class was another exciting race to watch, and Martinez won. We'll catch up with that report with Megawatt Matt Watson here in just a little bit. Right now we are about 17 minutes out, 2 hours and 14 and a half minutes into this race. Rodney Tomlin along with Johnny Gallagher and Matt Watson as Johnny rejoins us here in the pits. And Johnny, you've been out about a little bit. What's the field like out there in the pits? I know you talked to Corey at the NFAB and Pro Yamaha pits, but I know you also kept an eye on what was going on elsewhere.
Went out and was able to check out a few things, headed over to the 8.5 mile marker where there's a pretty gnarly rock garden. We're going to try and get an update from there here in just a little bit. We were working on some technical stuff, so those guys in the trailer are working on getting all that together and making it happen. Made a few trips through the pro pit, stopped in, checked up on some things we know, some things we don't. Obviously, we checked in with Johnny Campbell on audio there. We didn't have video, but he's not too thrilled with the penalty assessed to Chris Bach, but for the time being, at least, they're accepting it. They said they're going to try and confer further and see where they can go with that. But so that's one thing, obviously, bearing on the outcome of this race, as Chris Bach currently in the third-place position and not too far behind Ryan Sipes, potentially for that second-place spot. So that obviously could have a waiting outcome on our podium, depending on how that falls here at the end of the race.
Now, Johnny, I want to point out the fact that one statement that he made, and I want to expand on this just a little bit so people at home that are not familiar with GNCC might understand a little bit more about what's going on there. The penalty imposed, obviously, the inside of a white pole corner marker, he went, wasn't there, I don't know the circumstance of the situation, but Johnny had mentioned that there had been some course marking changes. And sometimes that becomes a necessity in the GNCC racing for one reason or another. There's a reason why they do it. So that's not really anything out of the norm that happens. And not saying, and I don't know how that hinges on what happened with Chris there, but just to let folks know, that is something that during a race it could happen depending on how conditions break down the track and things.
Certainly. Course markings are known to change throughout the race based on if a mud hole gets too gnarly, they'll go ahead and banner that off. Or if a section of track was deemed to be too far off the track, they'll go ahead and banner that off so that you can't continue to go that way. In speaking with those guys over in the JCR pits, obviously like you, I was in the trailer when all this happened, had no previous knowledge of it. Actually took a walk out there, talked to those guys. Actually went ahead over and went and looked at the section. We're actually trying to get a shot of it. It's just above the pro pits. We're trying to get the range of our live camera to head over to there to see if we can get an update on exactly what it looks like so the viewers at home, as you said, can have a better idea of exactly what's going on. But basically what had happened from the bystanders that I talked to, both from JCR and some other bystanders that had seen it happen, apparently it was on the first lap. Chris worked his way through there, ended up on the incorrect side of an AMSOIL banner with a white corner marker, did not turn around and go back the back way, but everyone agrees that, at least from what I've heard so far, no positions were gained and no actual time was gained. If anything, he may have lost a little time, but again, staying impartial to this, the time being for right now, Racer Productions officials, GNCC officials, have decided that he will be docked one position pending any further investigation or any further outcome. There has been some changes made. They went ahead and put some additional caution tape to alleviate any confusion there may be about exactly which way they're supposed to go in that section.
And one thing to point out about it is the officials are fair for that. Now, they do assess the penalty, but it's easier to go ahead and assess the penalty now and then rescind it later than it is to assess a penalty later after the race is all already said and done. So it makes sense to do what they have done. And it doesn't necessarily mean that that is going to hold, just like you say. I mean, there could be a lot of factors that could change that. And it's not necessarily, and it doesn't sound like it was anything intentional on the part of Chris Bach. Just if we had said something unexpected happening and got forced into a bad situation is kind of the way I look at it. So
yes, and actually the GNCC official or the GNCC course worker who had actually seen it made a comment that Chris Bach actually threw his hand up in the air in confusion as to where he was going. However, at that point, the decision was made that since he did not turn around and go back around the corner pole, that was why they chose to assess the penalty. Yeah. And that is where the kind of interpretation of things come into into play. The GNCC worker is saying that he felt Chris knew what he had done and should have turned around and gone back. JCR is saying that they feel Chris didn't know which way he was supposed to go, and that's why he didn't turn around. So that may ultimately end up being the deciding factor when they speak with Chris after the race, and he says, yeah, I knew I did it, and I didn't turn around, or, man, I didn't know which way I was supposed to go. But again, we're just speculating here in the booth, but one thing we know for sure that is not speculation, Caleb Russell out there on rails. Man, Rodney, any questions we had early in this race as to what the outcome was going to be? Obviously, with one lap of racing still remaining, a lot could happen, but Caleb Russell is really starting to erase any doubts as to if we've seen a chink in his armor, because today he is answering us with a resounding absolutely not.
Absolutely.
I am going to flex my muscle. I am going to show you my speed. I'm going to show you my consistency, my technical prowess, and, man, he's doing a heck of a job at it.
He most certainly is, and, you know, I think that was a good igniter for Caleb, because it fired him up. He went there last weekend, was able to win that national enduro race after the frustrating second place position finish. And that sounds funny because, you know, it's wild that a person reaches a point in their career where second place is just as bad as maybe a third or fourth or fifth or sixth in their mind because they're not winning. Look at this. Here comes that Sipes through now, still in the number two spot.
Yeah, Ryan Sipes in the number two spot, so now we will wait, and it looks like we have a couple of lap riders working their way through. Again, we know that this is at the five-mile marker, and from what we were told by Corey McDonald, Grant Baylor is going to be making an unscheduled pit stop at roughly the six-mile marker. Now, bearing in mind, there is a rule, GNCC XC1 riders must stop for fuel in the pro pits. That is the only place that they may refuel, barring the fact that they run out of fuel on the course. However, there is no rule against them making adjustments and or repairs to their machine out on the trail. So what he's going to do is we're going to see that's not Chris Bach there. We're going to see these guys work their way through, and just out of camera view, but we will actually be able to see it here from the Racer TV studios. It looks like Grant Baylor will be pulling off to the side. Corey McDonald will be potentially working on that machine and trying to get him righted, because what's going on right now, Rodney, is Grant is dealing with two handguards that are flopping around, much like as though, you know, they're not attached properly. So those things are bouncing, they're hitting his fingers, they're shaking his concentration as we watch Chris Bach work his way by at the five-mile marker. Now we wait and we watch for Grant Baylor, and there he is. Now take a note here. Look at this handguard on the right side. You can see it's just flopping freely. It's down. It's hitting him in the forearm. So Corey McDonald wants to go ahead and take that off. We're going to watch out the camera here in just a moment as they work their way by and see there goes Chris Bach as he goes by. Obviously, he is on his way at the 5.5 mile marker. Now we wait for as we turn the camera and we see Grant Baylor coming out onto the straightaway. Looks like that's Chris Bach. I was a little bit early. That was a lap rider we saw. So Chris Bach working his way by. Dale Cook, his mechanic, giving him a pit board. So we're going to see if we can get that camera dialed in so we can see. There we see Corey McDonald with his arms up in the air. Grant Baylor coming in. They're talking. He's working on the machine. We got to see if we can get this camera going. It looks like they made a quick adjustment, and Grant Baylor is on his way.
Wow.
So
that quick. You missed it, Jason.
it happens. We're... But it looked like they did. I'm not sure if he actually got it removed, but they definitely made a quick adjustment. Corey had tools in hand. They had a little discussion. I saw arms flailing, so something was done. Perhaps in the next camera shot, we'll be able to see if we've still got a right handguard that's flopping around in the wind, or if they went ahead and removed that thing.
That was quick, man. I mean, they barely even got stopped before he pulled back out, and giving Jason Frazee a little bit of a rough time. They're just playing with him a little bit. But regardless, that was quick. If they changed that, fixed that fast, wow, Corey McDonald is one heck of a mechanic, man, I'm telling you.
Yeah, you know, and again, we hate to keep talking about this because obviously we love to talk about racing action, which is what we're seeing on the camera right now. Caleb Russell, 7 mile marker, hammer down, making dust, passing lappers, doing everything right. He's just a few miles away from seeing a white flag, which is going to be a welcome sight for him, you got to believe. You know, you certainly couldn't say that this has been a downturn in the season for Caleb. You know, he finished second in one race, came out swinging last weekend at the Enduro, won the overall at that Enduro on a different machine. Now he's back here on his familiar mount. Obviously, whatever it was, the setup issues that they had. Boy, Rodney, I know you're no suspension expert. What do you think? Think Caleb Russell hit his setup today?
I think he was a lot closer today than he was in New York 2 weeks ago, that's for sure. And If he was a little off in the early part of the race, it looks like it's worked itself into right where it needs to be, and you know, it's come to him and come to the racetrack itself. Look at this.
There is Ryan Sipes as he works his way by at the 7. Caleb Russell now into the pro pits. So that's a good gap there, Rodney.
It is a good gap, but did you see how intensely that Ryan Sipes was still riding? I mean, here we are approaching 2 hours and 30 minutes, 2 hours and 24 minutes is where we are now. So it's looking, though, even though Ryan's a few seconds back, he's still got that intensity level that he's riding at. I think his endurance level is starting to strengthen here, because he seems to still be pretty strong here late in the race right now.
Well, in talking with Ryan and watching his riding, I don't necessarily know that if it was the endurance as much as it was the mental concentration for 3 hours that was really tripping him up. I think a lot of times it wasn't so much that Ryan was physically tired, as we see him working his way by here. BP Fuels Pro Row, oh boy, he's hard on the gas. He's not ready to settle for second anytime soon. He's hammered down. He knows he's got some guys in hot pursuit behind him that want that second place position. And also he knows that elusive first GNCC win is just a few seconds in front of him there. So he's hard on the gas trying to make it work. But again, I don't necessarily know, but I can't say for a fact, but it seems to me it wasn't the physical conditioning as much as it was the mental strength that it takes to keep yourself mistake-free for 3 hours. And that's where we're really seeing the evolution of Ryan Sipes as a racer. Physically, he's strong. Now we see our third-place rider, Chris Bach. He's working his way by at the 7-mile marker. Looks like he's a good bit ways back of Ryan Sipes now. He had closed that gap up quite a bit, and we'll have to wait and see. That is Grant Baylor, and it looks like that right hand guard at least is gone. Don't know if they're planning a second stop. And Thad Duvall, they're saying, was actually right behind Grant Baylor. So now we've got the 3, 4, and 5 positions working their way through at the 7-mile marker, and they should be working their way into the VP Fuels Pro Row. Looks like we've got Bach off in the distance, making a turn, and in about 5 seconds here, we should see him on camera. So he's making the turn at the bottom of the auxiliary pro pits, turning up, and here he comes, the number 9 JCR Honda of Chris Bach, and he is giving chase to Ryan Sipes a ways back right now, but in a podium position for the time being. Again, this is where that potential penalty looms so heavy right now, right?
Yeah.
We're talking about this final podium position. We've got Chris Bach holding it, Grant Baylor chasing it, Thad Duvall recharging. Seemed like he had lost a little bit of ground, but now he's back up, and they're really battling with those guys. And, again, with that one position penalty, that just looms so huge at this point.
Well, right now, you know, Grant Baylor is riding with a little bit of, aggravation in the back of his mind after the incidents there with the handguards and so forth, and trying to fix it. So now he's got Thad Duvall hot on his rear wheel, and that's another factor that he's going to have to try to – to work through out there. And this is a good test right now for that rider. And Young being in this XC1 Pro class like this, it's good to see him be able to rise to the occasion and see whether or not he's going to be able to stay there or not. And also, Johnny, I know you had a chance to head out there just a few moments ago and check some pretty cool things out over there in the wood sections, right?
Yeah, we were actually up. We took a trip up into some of the gnarlier sections of the woods here at the Rocky Mountain ATVMC Mountaineer Run, and we're able to get some footage, and I believe the boys in the trailer have put it together, and you can see a little bit more just how bad these rock sections are. And we're out here at the 8.5-mile marker. We've been talking all day about just how rough this course is and how treacherous these rock sections are, but it seems all that we really get a good glimpse of is these guys battling through the fields. Well, we worked our way out here. We're at the 8.5-mile marker. As we can see, there's riders coming right by me as I stand. This rock section is 20 yards wide, and the rocks are gnarly. We've got fans and spectators all around here checking out the action. We've seen riders dog paddle through here, try and keep their momentum up, but so many are struggling. In just a few moments, we should see our leaders working their way through, and we're going to see the difference in just how much speed they carry through some of these gnarly sections.
Wow, John.
And here he comes, folks. The factory FMF KTM, the number 1 machine of Caleb Russell, works his way through this rock garden. You can see he's taking this line to the far left, carrying so much speed. But even the best off-road rider in the world fumbles, has to dab his foot, loses just a few seconds. But right now, at least, he's pulling away from Ryan Sipes. We're going to have to see how this one ends here in just a moment.
Wow, Johnny, that's a pretty good look at what's going on there. You know, we talk about these rock gardens. It's been a while since I've been up the woods, a couple of years, and I'd forgotten just exactly how gnarly those rock gardens were. And that one in particular looked like it certainly was rather challenging.
Yeah, you know, we were up there for quite a bit and got to see many of the amateur riders work their way through. And, you know, Rodney, I got to say, as we've talked about so many times, hats off to these amateur riders. Majority of these guys, obviously, full-time jobs, families, you know, weekend warriors out here testing their skills against the best in the country. And these guys were doing everything they could to get their machines through. I mean, there was guys pushing, there was guys dog paddling, spectators were jumping in and helping people. And then even to see a rider like Caleb Russell, who we know practices his trials skills, we know does everything that he can to have the best bike control possible, and is the premier, one of the premier, if not the premier off-road rider in the country right now. And even he had a little fumble there.
Yeah, he did. And it looked to me like it was even tough to stand and walk on those rocks in reality.
It was. You know, I actually just about twisted my ankle a couple times, and I have to tell you from riding through that section yesterday, those rocks, they're slick, and most importantly, they are not stationary.
No.
They move around. They're just large enough that they can wreak havoc on you and your machine, but they're small enough that they're not stationary. So the weight of a motorcycle, even the weight of your feet and your body when you're walking, those things are constantly changing. The landscapes of terribleness underneath you is ever evolving. It's if you're sitting at home and you play video games and you know you're kind of designing a I guess a treacherous environment, come on out here into the woods at Masontown for the Rocky Mountain ATV MC Mountaineer Run, and we've got some stuff you haven't even dreamt up yet.
There you go. Here, your wildest dreams, well, here's something even wilder right there. Well, right now, 2 hours and 30 minutes into this race. We are looking at about a minute and 34 seconds, minute and a half or so, we'll say, before Caleb Russell will be at the finish line region, and that's going to put us then another 28 or 29 minutes away. We're going to be real close to a three-hour exactly race here once we do head into this final lap of racing. Pretty amazing how that's all going to work out, certainly.
Yeah, and now we see Tegan Temple, one of our XC2 riders, working his way through. And at last check, it looked like he was holding on to that second-place position with Nick Davis out front with a 2 minute and 13 second lead. So we've seen that race change up so much. Rodney, you guys talked about while I was gone, obviously Jason Thomas experiencing some issues, having to change a wheel. We got to see that on camera. And
is that Jesse going through there, I think, possibly? And there's Caleb Russell coming now towards the finish line, it looks like.
And, you know, Rodney, I got to say, Caleb Russell is probably really looking forward to seeing this white flag. And the reason I say this is Caleb Russell wanted to make a statement today. I don't know this from talking to him. I can tell it by the way he's riding. He set a torrid pace early, dropped everybody except for Ryan Sipes. Ryan Sipes hung tough. Finally, Caleb Russell turned the pace up even that much more and said, nope, not today, boys. You made what potentially was a little chink in my armor 2 weeks ago in New York, but today I'm going to show you why I am the man wearing the red number one, Caleb Russell, working his way through. Ricky Towery has that white flag in hand. There it goes, which means one more lap around this treacherous Mountaineer Run, and Caleb Russell will be headed towards, if he can keep it on two wheels and keep it moving forward, will be headed towards the sixth victory of 2015.
29 minutes, 40 seconds was the lap time on lap five at the end of lap six. Actually, I take that back. It was a 28:55 lap time last time around. It's a 28:22 here on lap number six. Apologize for that. 29:04 for Ryan Sipes on last time around, and he was 29 seconds back. At last check, he was about a minute, but what's the case now, Johnny? Looks like he's picked this pace up a little bit.
Yeah, you know, he's hard on the gas. I don't know that he's made up any time, but he definitely can see he's riding with a sense of urgency. You know, for him to be this close, obviously, on the podium 2 weekends ago in New York, now he's back. He's here in second place, and he's pushing hard. You know, you got to believe he's still in the back of his mind, wants this win. He's going to push hard for it all the way to the finish. He's going to make Caleb work as hard as he can. But most importantly, Ryan Sipes is just continuing to test himself against the elements. And what he's finding out is if he puts his best foot forward, obviously he can bang bars with the best riders in the off-road world, which we already knew. But to do it for 3 hours on a technical track like this, Rodney, I'm impressed. I'm incredibly impressed.
Well, I am impressed, too, because a 29:04 lap time last time around, a 28:45, he bested himself by about 19, almost 20 seconds. He is still a minute and 12 seconds back, but, yeah, I'm impressed as well with what Ryan Sipes has been able to do here today. And I think as impressive as anything is whether it's mental focus that was tough for him or whether it was physical or whether it was a combination of the both, is to see him overcome those obstacles that were presented to him in his transition to the off-road racing world. And I got to say, what we've seen out of the last two races alone, should be a pretty good indication that we might have a new player in the game out here.
Yeah, absolutely. And obviously with Ryan Sipes getting on the podium for the first time in 2015, had that podium at Ironman at the end of 2014, you know, we had kind of seen him come into his own at the end of the season, but to see him do it quite a bit earlier in the season and now seemingly looking like he's on his way to back it up. Holy cow, look at this, Rodney Tomlin. Thad Duvall, bad Thad, on the charge, exploding berms into the third place position. We knew he was coming. Well, he's here. He's onto the podium. He's not taking any chances on penalties. He's not taking any chances on anything. He's just going to twist that right grip on the side of that FAR Husqvarna. There's Chris Bock in the fourth place ride, crossing the line. One more lap to go for him. But Thad Duvall, hard on the charge, off in search of, could he possibly make up enough time to get in the battle for even that second place position with Ryan Sipes? Let's look at lap times and see.
Lap times right now are indicating a 28:22 for Caleb Russell, 28:45 for Ryan Sipes, a 28:40 for Thad Duvall. But the big problem there is a minute and 22 second gap. A 29:27 lap time for Chris Bock, a 29:27 lap time also for Grant Baylor. Here's the funny thing. At about the 5 mile marker, if memory serves me correct, Thad Duvall was back in fifth place position. And we had kind of alluded to the fact that what if he could get this and wondered if that would be a case. And amazingly, man, things have really just fallen into place, himself personally and physically making that push out there, and the war of attrition working out in his favor, it looks like.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, obviously, with Grant Baylor experiencing his issues with the handguards, which we believe was the cause of, from what his mechanic Corey McDonald said, a pretty gnarly crash just before the pro pits. So now we know he made at least one stop to remove that one right side handguard. The left side still there, dangling, still badly bent up. But Grant Baylor said, "Hey, man, I gotta go. I got a podium to chase after." Chris Bock, obviously pushing, but at the same time, Thad Duvall just pushing that much harder, turning in a minute faster lap than both Grant Baylor and Chris Bock that last lap around. So Thad Duvall, the man on the charge, up into that third place spot. As you noted, a minute 22 behind Ryan Sipes. So barring some kind of major charge, but then again, you know, well, I guess he was only 5 seconds faster than Ryan Sipes last lap.
Yeah.
Sipes turning in the 28:45 and Thad Duvall with a 28:40. So it's going to take a bit of a setback for him to get up into that second place spot. But you never know. Bad Thad's on the charge. And I got to tell you, when I was in the woods, there's a lot of bad Thad fans out here.
I don't doubt that a bit. And what an amazing ride that he's going to be able to put together after watching. I personally kind of rode him off about the midway point of the race, thinking that, well, he's not going to make the podium. But the last couple of laps have proved to be a little bit different as we check in with Caleb Russell, Ryan Sipes, Thad Duvall, your top three, Chris Bock in fourth, Grant Baylor rounding out the top five. And RacerTV.com's GNCC Live continues after this.
Introducing Slacker, the fastest, most accurate way to set your sag. Slacker is a digital sag scale based on measuring across the arc of the axle so you always get the right measurement. No more second guessing. See the measurements in real time. The remote display even allows single riders to easily take their own measurements. Unleash your bike's true potential with Slacker. Log on to motul.co now. That's motol.co.
Welcome back to GNCC Live as we check some great shots from around the area, and most importantly, I guess, just up the road in Morgantown, West Virginia, at the great West Virginia University, home of the West Virginia Mountaineers, and I tell you, beautiful facility as well as a great academic place, and a pretty good football and basketball team every once in a while too, Johnny Gallagher.
Hey, I'm from Ohio. I don't know anything about that.
And they know how to throw a party, or at least burn couches anyway. Win, lose, or draw, somebody's going to lose a couch.
I've had the opportunity to spend some time out in Morgantown. Great little city. One of my favorite places to visit. And like we've talked about so many times already today and so much this weekend, obviously the home of GNCC Racing, the home of Fraser Productions. And spent a lot of time racing here. Have had the opportunity to do a little bit of nightlife in West Virginia, and it's a good time for sure. Never did burn a couch, but I'll probably have to put that on my bucket list.
Well, right now, 2 hours, 39 minutes, call almost 2 hours, 40 minutes. We are expecting our leader, Caleb Russell, in for checkers in about 20 minutes or so, according to timing and scoring. Again, it's Russell and Sipes, a minute and 12 seconds apart, another minute and 22 seconds back. Thad Duvall has, over the course of the last lap, moved up from a fifth-place position into the number three spot. Chris Bach is now into the number four position as he drops back one after running in the number three position for a little while. And Grant Baylor, who was up in third and pushing, looked like he might be reeling in Ryan's, actually was wheel-to-wheel with Ryan Sipes there for a little bit, had a quote digger, as Corey McDonald called it, and messed up the bike a little bit, a couple hand guards broken off, and he's been trying to fight back from that ever since. So still a good day of racing, and if you look at the gap back there, it's another 2.5 minutes or so back to sixth place Jordan Ashburn. Stu Baylor's running seventh. Andrew DeLong has dropped back to eighth, and that's kind of odd, Johnny, to see Andrew DeLong back that far, especially with the type of fever that he was running with in the early part of the race. I mean, he looked like he was on mark today.
Yeah, you know, we saw DeLong obviously spent that time in the pits fixing that what was a damaged throttle cable. We saw him come out of the pits. It looked like he was hard on the charge. Turned in some really good lap times there, and I expected to see him battle his way up in towards possibly a top five, or as we alluded to, maybe even a podium position, but it appears that he's kind of stalled out, at least for now, in that eighth place spot, which is where he rejoined the race, just behind Stu Baylor. Looks like last lap, he was 3 minutes and 31 seconds behind Stu Baylor, so obviously DeLong either experiencing some issues or potentially just kind of not finding the groove after spending that time in the pits. So unfortunate for him, as you said, running in a third place position early. Looked like he was riding very well, and after finishing on the podium last weekend at the National Enduro, we had thought maybe we'd seen a resurgence from Andrew DeLong here at the GNCC. Again, unfortunately for him, and looks like we've got a clip here from a rider who got a little bit squirrely and grabbed that tree down at the mud hole at the 5 mile marker.
Let's see that one more time. Back that up. I want to watch that one more time. That was okay. Now this is how you don't do it.
You can see he carries his speed in there, but what happens is he just kind of gets his balance off, and the bike makes it through fine, but he shoulder checks that tree, and then the bike exits stage left, and he's left to go chase after it, looking like he's losing a few more positions in the process.
I chuckle, but I laugh because I've seen myself do that before in the past, not even racing, so I know what the poor guy was feeling like. Good thing, though, he bounced right back up, grabbed the bike, and got right back into it.
Yeah, he was back on his way in pursuit of whatever rider he was chasing in the first place.
Now, check this out. Let's look at the overall top 10. I just see where Ricky Russell has now regained a top 10 overall position as we check. Jason Thomas is back in the number 11 spot. So let's look at it. Russell, Sipes, Duvall, Bach, Baylor, that's your top five. Nick Davis, leader of the XC2 Pro Lights, is sixth overall right now. Jordan Ashburn running seventh. Stu Baylor, eighth overall. Tegan Temple, second in the XC2 Pro Lights. 3 minutes, 14 seconds behind your leader of Davis. Another 45 seconds back behind him is Ricky Russell. And 41 seconds behind him is Jason Thomas. Lap times, these guys all within the same range there, it looks like, except Tegan Temple actually turned to 30-38, which was about 40 or 45 seconds slower than Russell. In theory, at the checker flag, those two could be wheel-to-wheel.
Absolutely, and certainly you have to say you can't count Jason Thomas out of a potential podium position despite having to change that wheel, because although he is 41 seconds behind Ricky Russell, we know Jason Thomas is tenacious.
Yes.
And the minute they tell him, hey, podium spot, 41 seconds ahead of you, obviously the man from from Wales is probably going to go ahead and pin that KTM 250 and start skimming some rock gardens as though they're a supercross whoop section. So we'll have to keep an eye on that battle for sure. And as you said, the lap time's alluding to the fact that potentially Tegan Temple has been riding alone for so long. You know, he can't see Nick Davis. He's not really even in the same section of the track as Nick Davis with a 3 minute and 31 second deficit. But what his pit crew needs to let him know if they don't want to see him slip off that podium is he's got two seriously heavy hitters in Ricky Russell and Jason Thomas coming up hot on his six.
Yeah, and you got to wonder, I'm not taking anything away from Tegan other than the fact that this XC2 Pro Lights class late in the race, we know that he is capable of racing and hard and racing fast, but is he able to readjust this late in the race and regain and find that speed to push like he's going to need to here in these final few moments?
Yeah, you know, if I recall correctly, I was watching Tegan Temple's podium interview from New York, and he had actually stated he really didn't know what position he was in. He really didn't know what was going on. Sounds like there might have been a little bit of lack of communication there. And he wasn't really pushing himself. And he sounded a little disappointed that if he would have known he was doing so well, he might have pushed even a little bit harder and potentially been further up on that XC2 podium.
That's a pretty interesting insight there. And got to wonder if maybe the pit boards might be telling him what to do now. And maybe they'll inspire him here through this final lap of racing. Again, 2 hours now and 45 minutes into the race. Russell continuing to lead about 14 minutes and 40 seconds. Dude, if they finish on time, that's going to be a three-hour exactly race.
Yeah, that's they really hit the nail on the head with the calling of when to throw the flags and when to throw the two-lap board. So kudos to the girls in scoring and obviously Kirk over there. And then obviously Ricky Tower being the man holding the board. So we shoot for a three-hour race, and today they're going to hit it spot on. I know this morning things ran a little bit long, and on a treacherous course like that, nobody wants to spend any more time on their dirt bike than they have to.
Yeah, exactly, especially those rock gardens, man. I mean, they wear men out physically and mentally out there, and after 3 hours of trying to manipulate, maneuver through things like that, you're ready for a rest.
Yeah, you know, we were actually headed up to the start for the XC1 or for the afternoon race start, and WXC rider who finished second, Becca Sheets, was with me, and she said, you know, I was actually out of breath today. And I said, I don't necessarily know if it was because you were tired. And she said, well, what do you mean? I was breathing heavy, and I'm never breathing heavy. I said, were you actually breathing? She said, I never thought about that. I might have been holding my breath in those rock sections. Because that's how intense it gets, especially, you know, as you're working way through and those rocks are moving underneath you, you know, you're tensed up, your muscles are, you know, you're doing everything you can to kind of control that bike. And at the same time, you don't even want to take a breath because you feel just that, even that breath could upset you a little bit and throw you off your line.
That's amazing. Even in the rocks and in the woods, you got to remember to breathe. You know, you hear that a lot and often in motocross, breathe. And you see that on the pit board a lot, breathe. But that's something that you normally don't see or even hear talked about in GNCC. But the way you present that that problem and going through those rocks, it makes a lot of sense.
Well, Rodney, I speak from experience on this one because I have a big problem with that, not only in racing, but in general day-to-day tasks. Whenever I'm doing something taxing, for some reason I'll hold my breath and I don't realize I'm doing it. So multi-time women's champion Tracy Checo, Chris Borge, obviously six-time GNCC champion. If you guys are listening at home, because I know you tune in to keep track of things on Sunday just because you like seeing my beautiful face on TV and also watching, I know Borge is tuned in to watch Bach and DeLong and all his buddies, but they're always busting my chops about whenever I'm tightening bolts on a bike or whatever I may be doing, sometimes even eating, I'm holding my breath. So apparently somebody needs to follow me around during the day, just on an average Wednesday with the pit board that says,
breathe.
One guy that's got some breathing room right now is Caleb Russell,
yes,
with over a minute lead. Last check, 1 minute 12 seconds over the second place ride of Ryan Sipes. Caleb really looks smooth today. You know, he certainly didn't by any stretch of the imagination look off his game in New York. It
no.
just looked like he wasn't at 100% comfortable. You could see he appeared to be fighting the bike a little bit.
Yeah.
He wasn't sticking to his lines. Today, there's been none of that. Obviously, we saw a small bobble in possibly the gnarliest section of the track. But other than that, Caleb Russell has really looked on rails all day today, Rodney.
And he's ridden against some pretty stiff competition early in the race. And like you said, experience plays a big key in that. And he knew all he had to do was just ride back there and ride his pace, and things would fall into place for him. And that's exactly what's happened. But, I think that we've seen some real growth in this XC2 Pro or XC1 Pro class this weekend and today here at Marvin's Mountaintop, especially for Ryan Sipes. And I think that If you look, I think we're seeing some growth there by Thad Duval, especially if you look and think about what happened 2 weeks ago, you know, the dislocated hip soreness and still sore coming into this race day today. Still able to push like he is up into a number three spot. Chris Bach, gotta love what seeing out of him because he didn't let the successes from what took place there 2 weeks ago go to his head. He came out here, he knew he had a job to do, and he knew that was going to be a rather taxing job yet again, and he came ready to do exactly that, come to work. And though it may not be, at the moment at least, on the box or even a win, we're still seeing this progression forward because this is consistency starting to pay off. He's running strong top races back-to-back now.
Yeah, and what we just saw on screen was Ryan Sipes working his way through at the five-mile marker, so nearly halfway to completing this final lap. Doesn't appear, at least so far, that Thad Duval has made a big dent in that gap. We were kind of waiting to see, although they were running similar lap times. Obviously, Thad was on the charge, so it appears that that gap is somewhat stabilized, again, both from Sipes up to your leader, Caleb Russell, and then from Russell back to this man right here, Thad Duval. Appears it might be just a bit shorter than the minute 22 we last saw. Man, Thad Duval makes that section look easy. Wheelies right across that dip. Barely misses that tree that we saw that other rider shoulder check just a few moments ago. And Rodney, you know, you were commenting on the fact that, you know, Caleb Russell obviously had his struggles. I spoke with him after the race 2 weeks ago on the way home. We were doing some texting back and forth. And he honestly didn't seem like he was too shaken. He knew that he had fought an ill handling machine. He wasn't happy with the setup. He wasn't pumped about it, but it seemed like he wore the blame and the responsibility squarely on his own shoulders. He said that he was the one who had made the decision on the bike setup and came out with that bike setup, raced it, did not get the result he wanted, but he said, hey man, we know what to do. We're going to go back. We're going to fix the bike. Nothing to panic about. And, you know, we talk about all of these riders constantly evolving as we see Chris Bach and Grant Baylor working their way through on screen. So that is your fourth and fifth place riders. Now they're through at the 5 mile marker with just a few more miles to go until we'll see him again at the 7. We'll get a check in there. We should be seeing Caleb Russell approaching that section of track soon, as again, he's pulled out a comfortable gap. But going back to the Caleb Russell thing, I think we talk about Thad Duval and the newly gained consistency that he has this year. Well, Caleb Russell, in the past we've seen when he had some poor results or maybe not even the results that he wanted, you know, we've seen him kind of react to that. What we saw in New York, obviously, Caleb Russell comes to win, second place position, and he said it himself, hey man, this is nothing to lose your mind about. We got second, we had a good day, got beat, we're going to come back, we're going to make the changes to the bike, and we're going to go out and win the next one, and that's exactly what he's doing as we watch him here, charging his way through the dust from some lappers at the 7 mile marker. He looks dialed in, he's up on the pegs, he's still charging, so obviously Caleb Russell has made a statement here today, I'm back to win. I'm going to continue winning races. You guys haven't shooken me up just yet.
Exactly. And Caleb is, you know, the man to in a position to do that because it's all about the confidence. Confidence, confidence, confidence. And even riding with the way he rode last week, with the issues that he was having, he still rode with the extreme confidence. And that's what it takes to win championships. And he is looking like he is stepping one step closer to making that happen for a third time consecutively here in the AMSOIL GNCC Racing Championship Series. Right now we are 2 hours, 52 and a half minutes or so in, and Caleb Russell making his way through the 8 mile marker at the Pro Pits now, Johnny Gallagher. And this right here, just basically a part of the racetrack for him now because everybody knows that it looks like everything's going well and strong for him. So it looks like the Orange Brigade has moved their way over now to other sections of the track, more importantly over to the finish to congratulate him on what looks like is going to be, like you said, his sixth win in 2015.
Yeah, you know, Caleb Russell, we're still waiting on our second place rider at the 7 mile marker. Caleb Russell already passed the 8 mile marker, so obviously with over a mile lead, we know it's upwards of a minute. We're looking last check, it was a minute 12, as now we see Ryan Sipes working his way through the middle of two lappers, splitting the gap. And we're going to get a gap back to Thad Duval, so we're going to go ahead. It was 53:24 as he crossed that road there at the top of the 7. So we'll get a time here in just a moment as Thad works his way through. Look at that dust kicking up, Rodney. Limited visibility for sure. We're getting late in this show. I'm getting tongue-tied, and hopefully maybe we could see a charge from Thad Duvall, because regardless of how this one ends up, it'd be cool to see a battle coming down to the finish line. These guys have gapped themselves out just a little bit.
Yeah, you're absolutely right as we roll through the pro pits now, and this time we'll be looking for Ryan Sipes. There's Duvall right there.
So we were at 53.24, and now we are at 54 even. So it looks like about 38 seconds. So not quite what it was. It was at a minute 22, so that's a big change there for sure.
Big change, huge change. But the big question is he pushing hard enough and running fast enough to reel in Ryan Sipes for that second-place position? Regardless, remarkable ride by all three riders, and I'm not going to say just limit it to the top three here today. We've seen exceptional rides out this entire top five here today with Russell, Sipes, Duvall, Bach, and Grant Baylor. Each one of them, it seems like, has had some sort of an obstacle that they had to overcome at some point during this race today.
Yeah, and that was, again, it was right in the neighborhood of, looked to be about 35 seconds there for my timing. So he's made up 3 seconds there in less than a mile. So
wow.
We could be watching a nail biter coming down to the finish. And we know Thad very well, and we know he brings excitement, if nothing else. You know, he's an entertaining guy on and off the track. And, folks, you might want to, stay glued to your TV screens here and get a check of this, because Thad Duvall might be making a run at that second place spot. Ryan Sipes has held the lead for much of the day in that second place spot all day long when he wasn't in the lead, but Thad Duvall is saying he wants that spot.
He does want that spot, and here we come approaching the almost exact 3-hour mark at just over 2 hours and 55 minutes into this one right now. There is Chris Bach making his way through the pro pits now, Johnny, and it looks like he's still running with a pretty good fever and still running solid in fourth.
Yeah, and there's Grant Baylor in the fifth place spot. So those two, as they run on the track, fourth and fifth, again, we know we have some pending decisions to be made. And as of right now, Chris Bach has been assessed a one-position penalty, which means if things stand the way they are, although they'll cross the line, again, we don't know what's going to happen here as far as Bach holding onto that spot or Baylor being able to potentially make the pass. You got to wonder. I do happen to know. I checked in with them over there. They made the decision. They have not informed Chris Bach of the penalty. They've just decided to let him finish the race in hopes that they'll be able to get the penalty reconsidered. And even if they can't, they don't want it to affect his mindset. Now, Grant Baylor, assuming his crew knows about that, we don't know if they have relayed that message along that Bach is being assessed a penalty. Again, could it be a situation where they're hoping he gains that position on his own? We'll have to wait and see.
I would almost have to think that it would be in the best interest of those in the AmPro Yamaha pits not to inform, Grant in that situation and circumstance, in case it would be overturned later on. And then that way, if they do make the pass and get in front of them, they're not going to have to worry about it one way or the other.
Well, Rodney, I'll play devil's advocate on that one, because you said, obviously, if the penalty gets reversed, you know, he would potentially give that spot back. But then again, Grant charging, trying to make that pass on Chris Bach, if the penalty isn't reversed and Grant received that position anyway, should he have a mishap or a crash trying to make that pass and lose potentially more time and more positions, that would be a situation where obviously the AmPro team would have been in their best interest to inform him and let him know, hey man, you don't need this pass for this spot. Again, could come back to bite him either way, so it adds a little bit of more drama. You know, if we knew for sure that this penalty was going to stand, in my opinion, you don't inform him. Or you do inform him, I apologize. Because then, you know, hey man, you don't need this pass. If it happens, great. If it doesn't, don't force it. But at the same time, if they're thinking the penalty may not stick, they need to let him know, hey man, you need that spot.
That's a good point. Very good point. I can't argue with that one, Johnny, and can't argue with the fact that we're near the completion of this race either, as Caleb Russell is on a roll, and my estimation of a 6-minute win is certainly not going to come to pass, but we're going to be looking at a minute and a half or better as we're watching these riders out here near the 7-mile marker now, and Johnny, still some pretty intense fever they're riding with.
Yeah, we just saw Nick Davis work his way past at the 7-mile marker. Obviously, we know he has a seemingly insurmountable lead at this point of 3 minutes and 31 seconds at last check, I believe that was, over the second-place rider of Tegan Temple. But we'll wait and we'll watch, and that was actually Jordan Ashburn, who just came by our camera, who is in the 7th-place overall position and in the 6th-place spot in that XC1 Pro class. So that NFAB FMF KTM rider close behind his teammate Grant Baylor, who's in the 5th place spot. So again, the top five in the XC1, Caleb Russell, Ryan Sipes, Thad Duvall, Chris Bach, Grant Baylor, followed by Jordan Ashburn, Stu Baylor, And then we go back to Andrew DeLong, who was our eighth place rider at last check. Now we see Jordan Ashburn working his way through the pro pits as he passes the VP Fuels Pro Row in pursuit of Grant Baylor, and also knowing that he's actually been we've got a truck going backwards on the track. He's not a part of the race. He's just trying to head home, packed up a little early, and luckily I'm sure they scouted that to make sure that was safe before they did it.
Yeah, I'm sure they did. That normally, the folks that would be doing something like that would be in a position to do just exactly that. They've got folks around the corner watching to make sure they could cross the track right there. But regardless, I'm looking at this XC2 Pro Lights class now, Johnny, and some big changes throughout the course of the day. Nick Davis with the lead heading into the final stretch here. Tegan Temple in second. Ricky Russell up to third. Jason Thomas in fourth. We see the Lane Michaels up to fifth. Trevor Bollinger in sixth. Jesse Grom in seventh. Austin Lee is eighth. Corey Buttrick now up to ninth. Craig DeLong rounding out the top ten. Seems like we got a lot of the same players. A few little changes here and there, but here late in the race, man, it's been all Nick Davis in this class, and I know keeping an eye on Jason Thomas as to whether or not he's going to be able to make up that,
41 seconds behind Ricky Russell, who was in turn 45 seconds behind Tegan Temple. As we see Caleb Russell, 11-mile marker. We're watching the 7. This guy's already at the 11.
There it is.
He's on the gas.
3 hours into this race exactly, and Caleb Russell making his way through the final chicanes here at this Rocky Mountain ATVNC.com Mountaineer Run GNCC. And just a couple of turns away, Caleb Russell back to his winning ways. And Caleb Russell, ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together for this rider as he takes the win. Win number 6 here in 2015, and the win at this Mountaineer Run GNCC. Two hands up in the air and a big sigh of relief. Again, it was only a second-place position. The only thing hurt there, I think, at last round with that second-place spot for Russell was the fact that he was no longer looking at a perfect season, but at the same time, I think that might have relieved a little bit off his shoulders, too. Now he can just go out and worry about riding and not worrying about, I have to win just to get that perfect season. But here we go. The big question is how far back to the number 2 spot. The official timing on this one, Johnny, 3 hours, 44 seconds.
Yeah, and as we wait for Ryan Sipes, we'll have to keep an eye on that 7-mile marker as well, because we know that second, third, and fourth place spot battle in the XC2 class could be really heating up. So we should see Tegan Temple checking his way in there at the 7-mile marker. All right, Tegan Temple has checked through at the 7-mile marker. I'm actually watching across the hillside and can see from here.
There comes
Sipes.
So we'll
wait and see. Here comes Sipes into the finish, the 11-mile marker. This guy's put on a phenomenal charge today. He rode with Caleb Russell, was right there with him, battling, pushed him, passed him, led much of this race, and is going to come home with a well-earned second-place spot here today.
Well, I'll tell you what, it looks like we got a new player in the GNCC Racing Nation, and he goes by the name of Ryan Sipes, and he rides on a Rockstar Energy Air Group-backed Husqvarna, and he makes his way through the final few turns now to a second-place position finish in GNCC and his best ever here in the off-road racing world. Ryan Sipes has made his mark, and Ryan Sipes feels like he may have just won this race today, Johnny Gallagher.
Yeah, you could see with that fist pump, he's obviously happy about that one, and he certainly has a reason to be so.
Yes.
You know, he's
one step closer.
He's experienced a lot of struggles this season and last, and oh, look at this, Thad Duvall coming so close to reeling him in there, but he's working his way through the final turns, no goggles on, probably took those off to get a little bit of extra air, you know, cool himself down. He's charging hard. So Bad Thad on the box today here at the Mountaineer Run. You can see he just looks relieved.
Yes, he does. A minute, 22 seconds down to a 28-second deficit. Wow, shaved almost off an entire minute there. Impressive ride by Thad Duvall there, especially knowing what happened a couple of weeks ago. And look at this.
And here is Grant Baylor. Looks like he has made the pass on Chris Bach for that fourth-place spot. Unless we miss Bach, we'll have to wait and see. Doesn't look like it. So we've got Grant Baylor now working his way through. So we've got Baylor working his way through this corner, and it looks like he is going to take that fourth-place spot outright, regardless of what happens with that penalty assessed. Baylor, handguards flapping and all. Actually, it looks like they've removed both sides. Oh, nope, the left side's still hanging down there. With a little bit of a shadow, we missed it. But Grant Baylor certainly experienced some struggles with a digger, as you said, Corey McDonald pointed out. But he was up charging for nearly a podium spot, coming across the line in fourth. So those are good, solid points for Grant Baylor today.
Most certainly is. 54 seconds back on that one, and still pushing hard at the end. Grant Baylor will finish up in fourth. Looking for Chris Bach to, and there he is rolling across the line in fifth. And you got to say, still another good ride by Bach today, as he was up in it for a little while, and, you know, maybe there toward the end, don't know, not sure what happened. But, again, in these types of conditions and this type of racetrack, you know, it's one of those situations and circumstances, anything can happen out there. And it looks like whatever it was brought Chris Bach back to the number five spot. But I'd say a lot of that would have been the intensity and fever that Grant Baylor was riding on those last couple of laps, to be honest with you. So Bach, it rounds out your top five, and we now begin to wait and watch to see what's going to be taking place in the XC2 Pro Lights. There's about a minute and a half to go in this one. And Johnny Gallagher, Nick Davis, Tegan Temple, Ricky Russell, your top three right now. Jason Thomas, though, remember, who led the biggest part of the day, having to leave the track at the five-mile marker and then resume that race after changing the back wheel, was running 41 seconds back behind Ricky Russell and was pushing hard there. And you got to wonder whether or not he is going to be able to push all the way back up into a podium spot. That'd be pretty remarkable if he did, even for Jason Thomas. Lane Michael rounding out the top five heading into this final lap. Then it's Trevor Bollinger, Jesse Grom, Austin Lee, Corey Buttrick, and Craig DeLong, your top 10. And, of course, you know, Johnny Gallagher getting ready to step out. And, funny you mentioned this. We haven't mentioned it once yet as far as who our top amateur overall is today. But it looks like Mark Horesco was riding in contention. He was running 21st place overall aboard the number 412 out of Pittsburgh. But he was only doing it by 1 second over the 552 of Anthony Stone. Stone had slowed his pace down by nearly a minute behind Horesco. So one has to wonder here now what's going to be taking place between these guys. Less than 2 seconds between them, Horesco and Stone. It could be up between those two as far as the amateur overall is concerned. So we'll be watching that one with bated breath, to say the least there. And still only our top five had checked in with seven laps complete here. Russell, Sipes, Duvall, Baylor, and Bach. As we'll see for ourselves on the Rocky Mountain ATVMC leaderboard here shortly. And we'll also be awarding our Twitter contest winner and letting you know who is the recipient of $250 in AMSOIL product. We're playing along today in our AMSOIL Twitter contest and hashtagging GNCC Live. Again, it was, who do you think is going to be on the podium? It doesn't matter whether you're right. We just want to see the folks that you're cheering for and rooting for. And they're in the process of getting all those names into the big old Hatto names right now, and they'll draw out here in just a few moments. As I believe Nick Davis makes his way in, folks, and back to the center of the podium for the XC2 Pro Lights class. Nick Davis making it happen. Here in the state of West Virginia, the fist pump. He said a year ago this is where it all started for him as far as getting things on track, and he had hoped to be able to maybe pick up and, well, do that again here this year after a lackluster start, well, after an injury anyway, after a couple of good races. And he comes into this one and puts it all to work, puts the plan in motion, and is able to capture that win in the XC2 Pro Lights. Tegan Temple, 3 minutes, 14 seconds behind him. We'll be watching and waiting to see if he can hold on to second. Ricky Russell looking to see if he's going to be able to hold on to third. Behind him is Jason Thomas in fourth with Lane Michael rounding out the top five. Well, a race that took, it looks like 3 hours and 44 seconds for Caleb Russell. He took the whole shot this morning, picked himself up an extra $250, or this afternoon, picked himself up an extra $250, and then waged war with one of the new players, it looks like, in the GNCC Racing Nation. It comes in the form of a former motocross star, talking about Ryan Sipes, as he does it two races in a row, two podiums, but more importantly, he progresses from third now to a solid and strong second-place position finish. And, of course, Thad Duvall will round out the top three. We're going to take a quick break, and we'll be back with podium celebrations, also our top amateur and more, as GNCC Live continues on RacerTV.com.
The Sunstar Work Z rear sprocket is made of stainless steel, making it 3 times more durable than a standard steel sprocket. Team it with the 520 XTG triple guard sealed ring chain with 3 lubrication pools per side. Durability in the toughest condition.
This Racer TV live broadcast is brought to you by AMSOIL, the first in synthetics. By Rocky Mountain ATV MC, get ready. By Maxxis Tires, find your flow. And powered by Yamaha Generators.
Welcoming you back here to Marvin's Mountaintop, where leading into the weekend, our GNCC pastor from Team Faith and also our part of our outreach program there went to the local schools and entertained and also informed a lot of the area youth about anti-bullying campaigns and, of course, about teamwork and so much more that we tried to focus on here in the GNCC Racing Nation. And, you know, I was talking to Chuck LeMaster. He said, you know, I've seen several of the students and several of the teachers come out this weekend and say, hey, you were out of school on Friday. Hey, you were out of school. So it's obviously an uplifting experience for those kids and those even the teachers around the area. So I want to say thanks to Chuck LeMaster for all the work that he puts in on the, well, off the clock, so to speak, leading into the race weekends. And right now we are looking at the way this race all broke down. What a day. You hear the celebrations getting ready to get underway at the podium right now. Caleb Russell, Ryan Sipes, Thad Duvall making their way over to the podium. Grant Baylor finishing in fourth. Chris Bach was fifth. Nick Davis, this is overall right now, took sixth. Jordan Ashburn took seventh. Ricky Russell, he was second in the XC2 Pro Lights class, finishing eighth overall. Stu Baylor took ninth overall. Tegan Temple holds on for a third-place position overall. He was running second. Ricky Russell looks like might have tracked him down here in this final lap. And again, the battle for the top amateur is still waging on between Michael Witkowski and Mark Horetzko in that 258 class. No, I'm sorry, that's Mark Horetzko and Anthony Stone. Sorry about that. Horetzko and Stone battling it out for the overall amateur honors. We'll find out more about that in just a few moments. But right now, we're going to head on over to the podium and Max's Victory Lane, where Megawatt Matt Watson stands by with our top three here at this Mountaineer Run GNCC.
All right, thanks a lot, Rodney. Here we are on the podium today, our XC1 winners.
Is that coming across, Scotty?
Check.
Mega, you're working, buddy. Keep going. You're talking. Keep going.
I've got the yellow mic turned on. We've got no sound.
Check.
Well, everything
check.
Seems to be working. Mega, can you hear me down there on
any
the podium
podiums?
Right now?
Check.
Let me check the
Well, looks like a little bit of a technical issue down there. I think it might be resolved here pretty quick.
Radio check. Check. Radio check.
Let's just hope he doesn't say anything off color. Well, let's step away from that for just a second. We'll kill his mic until he gets things sorted out as far as the podium. As soon as they can hear me down there, they'll know that things are golden, and we'll get podium celebrations.
Check.
What I want to do is opportunity to
we working
remind
yet?
You
we got
of
sound
some
yet?
Upcoming activities
check,
that
check.
Be taking place as far as RacerTV.com is concerned. Next Saturday, we'll be
here
at the Ironman. Home of the Ironman GNCC, which will be for the ATV Motocross National. First time they've ever stopped there. 2:30 to 5:30 next Saturday, and then we'll be back with Wise Coach John Pinton GNCC on Saturday, June 6th and Sunday, June 7th, and that'll be for round 8. You'll catch that all the action right here on GNCC Live at RacerTV.com. Don't forget to mark on your calendars also June 20th and June 21st. We will be at the AMSOIL Snowshoe GNCC, Snowshoe Mountain Resort there. And I believe that we may be ready to go now as we head back down once again to Maxxis Victory Lane with Megawatt Matt Watson.
All right, thanks a lot, Ronnie. Everybody put your hands together for our top three in XC1. Make some noise, West Virginia. Let's hear it. Yeah, got our top three overall up here today. A great race. Thad Duvall in our third position over here. Now, Thad, last time I talked to you, I actually talked to you through your dad, man. You was laying on the back of the trailer just in a... little bit of a bad way up there in New York. Tell us a little bit what's happened between now and then and how we finished up today.
At New York I had a pretty big nasty get off and dislocated my hip and hit my head pretty hard. But I gave it a week rest and decided to hop on the bike and give it a go, and I felt good at home. And I wanted to get through today. I'm still a little off, but beginning of the race, I got a pretty good start, and I just struggled really, really bad. I couldn't get going, and I just rode around in fifth all day, and just threw myself a pity party, I just struggled riding my bike. It wasn't a very good setup, and the last two laps, I told myself, hey, I don't want to get fifth. I want to give it a charge, and I wasn't. I had a lot left in the bag, so I shifted up a gear and said it's now or never. And I went from fifth to third in two laps and almost caught Ryan at the end. So I felt good. I feel good. I worked really hard the last 2 weeks, and I think it paid off today.
Yeah, I think so, man. We've seen that Thad Duvall mode before, so real proud of you today. I know you got a huge team behind you, a bunch of people you want to thank.
Yeah, first of all, DQ, he's been taking my race bike back to Indiana and prepping it, and it seems to be working. My dad, he's my full-time practice mechanic pretty much. He's always spinning wrenches. The whole KR4, FAR, Fred Andrews, he stepped up and gave me the ride this year. Rocky Mount, Amsoil, Fly, Max's Tire, WRP Bars, CD Boost, Scott Goggles. Just everybody out there that was cheering me on today. It's so awesome coming to some hometown races and listening to all the people go wild. And I come to a rock garden, and even if I bobbled, they'd be right there. So it was fun, and just want to thank everybody for cheering me on today. Thanks.
Well, us crazy hillbillies, we love a good race, man. West Virginia, give it up for your own Thad Duvall right here in third place. Right on. Hey, we make our way over here to Ryan Sipes. Now, Ryan, hey, 2 weeks in a row up here on the box. Two events in a row, man, up here on the box. Now, I told him early in the race you were one of my top three Twitter picks. And I said it's going to get tough, and it's going to take tough guys today. Tell us about it.
Yeah, it was gnarly out there. It was just as bad as I remember it last year. Just the rocks. It's really hard to be smooth or be precise out there. You're kind of just hoping for the best, hitting those rocks and try to use your legs a lot, and my bike was definitely awesome. I don't think any suspension could soak up all those rocks, but it was a fun race. Me and Caleb had a good time out front there, and that pace was fun. Definitely wore me out towards the end of the race, but I'm happy to be up on the box again and one spot above last week, so we're good.
Congratulations, man. Great job, and who helped you get this thing up here in number two spot today?
I got to thank all my sponsors, Air Group, Radiant Logistics, Rockstar Energy, Husqvarna, MSR Gear, Liat, Neck Brace, Dragon, FMF, Dunlop, WIMS, Mika Handlebars, Spider Graphics, Acherby's, Plastic, and everybody else, thank you so much.
Right on. Congratulations on second place. Make some noise for Ryan Sipes. And move over here into the middle one more time. KR1, Caleb. I got to ask you, man, looked like you were having a good time riding with Sipes out there. You guys both look casual, both loose on the bike, and were carrying an amazing pace in the beginning of the race.
Yeah, it was a good deal. I think I got the whole shot.
You did. That's coming up.
Yeah, so I was pumped on that, and I tried to get going, and right away I messed up in one of the first little rock gardens, and Sipes got around me, and we kind of went back and forth a few times the next couple laps, and just it was really tough the first few laps reading the trail and not knowing where some rocks were you could hit, with the front wheel and just kind of fall over. And once we got everything figured out, I got back around them, and I was like, all right, I'm going to try to get away here. And I was able to pull a little gap and just keep pulling. And I'm really surprised with Ryan. For a motocross guy, he's done pretty good on some of the most technical tracks the last two. So it's gonna be he's gonna be a tough competitor next year, and he's getting better every race.
Right on. Hey man, I know that you've got a huge list. You got a solid, strong team behind you, and I know you want to thank everybody for making this possible again.
Yeah, I got to thank FMF KTM, Bell Helmets, CD Boots, Dunlop Tires, WP Factory Services, my wife, my family, my mechanic Tanner, and everybody underneath the team that helps out. It's It makes the job a lot easier. Thank you.
Yeah, congratulations on first place again. Make some noise, you guys. Everybody's favorite part. Hold that Mountaineer up high right there, Caleb. Let everybody get a good look at that. It's everybody's favorite part of the celebration right now. A little champagne spray from our winners. All of these guys pretty adept at the bottle. That's for sure. They know exactly what's going on. All these guys look thirsty down here, Ryan. That's for sure. Oh, we got to get our picture first. That's right. Forgot about it, Ken. Look at that. Kenny Hill about to get me. I'm getting a finger tossed at me right now. Not the middle one, the first one. So we're in good shape. Hey, make some noise, West Virginia. Let's hear it. These guys put the show on for 3 hours. Let's hear it. Right on. Right on. Now it's time to grab them bottles and get busy. So all these kids down front looking for a little bubbly shower right now.
Well, as the celebrations continue down on the podium, as we always like to say in GNCC, to the victor goes the spoils, and the spoils, the sweet, sweet spray of champagne here today, you know. The crowd enjoying that, and I'm sure it's the sweetest spray of champagne that Ryan has seen in some time, and at least here in GNCC Racing, as he bests himself and betters himself one more spot. The only thing that he hasn't done now, it stood in the center of the box, so he's got one more goal that he's got to achieve here. Going to be making it happen soon. And there he is, your XC1 Hole Shot Award winner. That's Caleb Russell picking up an extra $250 from our friends at All Balls Bearings and Components. And we want to salute those folks and say thanks to those guys for making that all possible. Of course, All Balls, a huge and monumental part of GNCC Racing for many years, and becoming even more of a part and bigger part of GNCC Racing this year. And remember, All Balls Racing is an industry leader for high-quality aftermarket replacement parts for ATVs, dirt bikes, snowmobiles, motorcycles, and UTVs. From bearings to cables, CV boots to master cylinder kits, All Balls Racing has you and your ride covered. Well, as we wrap up XC1 podium here, we've got XC2 Pro Lights getting ready to come to the stage in just a moment. But on the stage earlier today in Max's Victory Lane, we saw some great battles out in our WXC class in our 10 o'clock race, and Casey Martinez was able to come out on top. Megawatt Matt Watson caught up with her earlier this morning.
Welcome back to RacerTV.com. We're here with Casey Martinez, third overall this morning and first overall in our WXC. Casey, I got one thing to say. You're a badass. That's all I got to say about it. Each and every week, up front in the WXC, and you're determined to get this top podium, aren't you?
Yeah, I am. This weekend was pretty tough. I feel like I've been here the last 3 years now in a row, and I feel like every time I get here, once I get on that course, that first lap, I forget how many rocks there really are out there. It's pretty brutal. I was pretty shocked how many rocks there were, and it was slippery, but I'm happy to go away on the top spot.
Let me tell you something. Megawatt almost counted you out on the third lap. I almost counted you out. And let me tell you something. You put the gas to it. You came through the rock sections, the rock gardens. And, man, here you are again, first WXC, third overall.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, it was crazy out there. I definitely, had to ride smart and stay on the bike. And I went down that second lap, and I had to regroup from there. A lot of girls got around me. So from there, I just tried to ride my own race and make smart moves and get up on top.
All right. Hey, who's the short list to put the 496 back up on the box again?
What do you mean?
Who's the short list of sponsors that helped you?
Oh, yeah. FMF, Factory Racing Team, KTM, CD, Thor, Motorsport, and Lipzip. They all helped me out really good, and I can't thank them enough.
Awesome. Thank you so much. And back to you guys in the studio.
All right. Thanks a lot. Megawatt, that was a nice podium there with Casey Martinez, congratulating her on yet another win and a well-deserved win. And talk about well-deserved wins and some big things happening in the GNCC Racing Nation today. We talked about big things possibly changing and maybe some jaw-dropping moments. Well, we may have witnessed that in the XC2 Pro Lights class. Let's head on down to the Max's Victory Lane, where Megawatt Matt Watson stands by once again with a top three in this class.
Hey, thanks a lot, Rodney. We're going to let Ken Hill get his pictures taken care of here real quick before we start our interview. If you guys want to move right to the center of the podium, if we could get Ricky over here in the middle real quick, we'll let Ken Hill get our photos. Hey, make some noise, you guys. Our top three overall for our XC2. Hey, how about this? Tegan Temple win third place. Ricky Russell win second place. And Nick Davis taking the win today. Got in a lot of exciting stories, man. We're going to start with this guy right over here, man. Teagan Temple, man. Best ride of your career?
Nah, the second best. Last time I was in second, and, you know, I rode hard all day. I was battling Jesse, and that last lap, I kind of faded a little bit, and Ricky just capitalized, and I had nothing for him. But had a great time, and happy with third.
You know, the last one was second, wasn't it? I thought it was third. But, hey, I want to tell you something. An impressive ride out there today. The bike looked like it was working great.
Yeah, you know, got to give it up to Bud Meadow. You know, we've been working all with more rough stuff, but in the rocks it handled great and couldn't be happier with it.
Right on, man. Who else helped you put this thing up here on the box today?
John Ross at Ride On Moto, Cycle Playground, Meadow Cycle, Ride PG, Galfer, Motorex, FMF Rental, the Hammer Crew, my mom, my dad, my sister, the Hickses, the Shawls. I think anybody else I missed, everybody else cheering me on, family, friends, thank you.
Right on, congratulations. Come on, West Virginia, let's hear it. Teagan Temple, third place, making our way over here to Ricky. Ricky, you know, I watched you come off the track. I watched you over there. You've got a little bit of just a neutral look on your face right now, man. You got second place today. That's a great ride in these conditions, man.
Yeah, just the first half of the race, I'm really struggling. I just have no flow and find myself in back in, I don't know, fifth, sixth, where I want to be up front. And start to figure it out towards the last hour, but by then it's too late. But I was happy to still get back up to second.
Hey, man, when you turned it up, was there a certain spot on the track that you knew you could click off a couple guys every time? Was there a place you would like to make a move?
Just had to focus on each section. Each section, make sure I did everything clean and just get through everything as fast as I could and not lose focus.
Right on. Well, I know the Blue Crew is awful proud. Who else do you want to thank for getting up here and getting second place today?
I got to thank the whole team, the Brains Riding University, Atlas Yamaha, FroadBiking.com, Fast Company Flex Bars. Those things are great. Factory Connection Suspension, Stickman Graphics, Dwayne here helping me pit, Kenda Tires, GPR, Unibiker, Evans Cooling, Carb Sport. Just everyone back home cheering me on, everyone out here pointing lines and helping us get up here on the podium.
Awesome. Congratulations on second place. Put your hands together, you guys. Make some noise for Ricky Russell. Right on. Hey, we'll make our way over here into the center. Nick Davis. Nick, rough out there today.
Yeah, it was pretty good. Being from PA, I like the rocks, and I really enjoy this track. Last year, it was kind of my breakthrough ride for KR4, and hopefully we'll start it over again.
Right on, man. Now, take us from the start, man. Just what was your mindset as soon as the flag dropped, man? This thing lit, and what happened?
Yeah, I got a pretty good start, and actually Teagan, he swung her pretty wide in the first turn, and kind of we hit. I almost went down and got back around and then just made some quick passes fast and got behind Jason, and he was ripping on the start, man. He hammered down, and we came out into, like, the big field section over there, and I looked back, and there was nobody. So I was like, all right, well, I'll follow him for a little bit, and then he started making a lot of mistakes. I think he got tired, and I just capitalized and put the hammer down, and I got on the pit board that I was, like, 2:30 out over Teagan, so I was like, all right, we'll just cruise her in for the last two laps.
Right on. Hey, I got to tell you, when you pulled off the track, you looked pretty fresh, man. You looked like you had plenty left. Were you good for a couple more laps?
Yeah, definitely. I was, I guess I had a lot of fun today. Smiled the whole time, so it was like effortless for me. It was one of them days, you know, where nothing you could do would go wrong. Like, I hit stuff where other days I would have crashed, and today I just pulled it out, so I was super happy with it, and look forward to the next one.
Right on. One more time. Make some noise, West Virginia, for our winner today, Nick Davis. Congratulations to all these guys, Teagan Temple, Ricky Russell, and Nick Davis. Nick, now I think these kids are waiting on something down here. I think they look a bit thirsty right in front of you, bud. Congratulations to all you guys. And we're coming up next with our top amateur award, Mr. Johnny Gallagher. And I have a hole shot award.
Well, champagne celebrations are complete, and now it's time for the swag bag to come out as Nick Davis celebrates a win here and one that is certainly putting his 2015 ride back on track. And hopefully, I know he's thinking that this is just the first of many and some good racing ahead. As we say congratulations once more to Nick. I also want to remind folks while we're resetting the podium and getting Johnny Gallagher and our top amateur of Anthony Stone from the 258 class ready to go. Don't forget, we got the ISDE fundraiser coming up. It's Golfing with a Purpose. You and your friends will enjoy 18 holes of golf while supporting the USA ISDE trophy team at the annual golf fundraiser on Friday, June 19th at the Raven Golf Club course at Snowshoe Mountain Resort. Your job is simple. Round up a foursome, register for the event, and be ready to swing big. All golf fees include green fees, cart, and clubhouse amenities, as well as lunch. Highlights include longest drives and closest to the pin contest for men and women, and putting contest, as well as mulligans and more. For more information, contact events at ktmusa.com. That's events at ktmusa.com. And now, Hole Shot Award. Looks like our Hot Cams Hole Shot Award going to be going out here to is that Craig DeLong, it looks like.
It is, Rodney. Craig DeLong up here with our XC2 Hole Shot Award. Craig, you kicked the kicker over, that thing lit, and you were shot out like a cannonball, man.
Yeah, that was probably the best part of my day, actually. It's just, I got to the first turn first. Got around first and crossed the line first. So, I mean, that was probably the best part. And once I got in the woods, I just started going backwards.
Well, you'll have that some days, but you know what? Thanks to Hot Cams, you got an extra $100 and AMSOIL for your effort today. And who do you want to thank for helping you get that hole shot?
I definitely want to thank Husqvarna North America, Timmy Wagon, and Moose Racing, CD Boots, Motorcycle Superstore, FMF, Enduro Engineering, Dunlop Tires, Bellray Oils, friends and family. Thanks for coming out, and see you at the next one.
Awesome. Well, congratulations on the hell shot. We know we'll see you back stronger than ever in a couple weeks. That's for sure. Craig DeLong, you guys. Give him a big round of applause. Yeah. All right, we got one more award. Our man, Johnny G. This guy could have a job for Access Hollywood. Look at him. This guy's a pro right here, no doubt about it. Johnny G with our top amateur award today. Thank you.
All right, folks, give it up for we've got Anthony Stone, today's top amateur winner, and our 250A winner. Come on over here, Anthony. Anthony, we were just watching you battle across the finish line a few moments ago. You and Mark Horesco were wheel-to-wheel. You guys were wheel-to-wheel all day long for that 250A win and for the top amateur award. But you get to hold the check. You get the medal. You get the cup. Good day for you. You've got $125 from American Cargo. They're going to help you out with some fuel money to get to the next race. Tell us a little bit about how things went for you today, Anthony.
Well, it got off good. I was second or third off the hole shot, and I passed everyone, and I pulled about a minute and a half lead, and my suspension was working real good, then all of a sudden it just, like, died. And it started beating me up, and I kind of got a little sick. And then Horesco caught up to me after I wrecked. And from there, I just knew I just had to charge and charge. And I ended up passing him at the top of the hill, and somehow I managed to pull it together.
Well, this is your first top amateur award for the year. This is actually your first top amateur award of your career. We've seen you up here on this podium before in the youth ranks. You have already earned a 250A win in 2015, but with this being your top amateur overall, how's this feel? And are you going to come back gunning for another one in 2 weeks when we go to the John Penton?
Yeah, I'm going to go home and train as hard as I can and do whatever I can to get back up here.
All right. Well, I'm sure you got some people you want to thank. You didn't get up here by yourself. We'll give you a chance to thank those people.
Morgantown Power Sports, Moose, Maxis, HBD, Preston Contractors, Anderson Excavating, Joey Steele. He does awesome suspension. He'll test with you if you call him. He's a great guy. And I'd like to thank everyone for coming out, all my family for watching me, and my mom and dad for helping me, and my dad staying late out at the garage and working on my bikes.
All right, well, you can't ever forget those parents. All right, folks out there, give it up one more time. Anthony Hill, today's top amateur overall. And back to you, Rodney.
Well, congratulations, Anthony, on your big accomplishment today and also the extra $125 from American Cargo. And, wow, what another race weekend we had as we wrap up the midway points, or the midway race, I guess we should say, of the 2015 season, round 7 of 13. And Like we said, just a lot of crazy things happening. Yesterday's ATV race giving us some new perspectives and insights to what this championship is shaping up for those guys. And again, here today, we got to see Caleb Russell rise back to the center of the box. But in the process, we also got to see a new player born into the game of GNCC Racing, going by the name of one Ryan Sipes, for sure. So congratulations to him. Congratulations to Caleb. And as well, congratulations to West Virginia's own Thad DeBall for his third-place position finish here today. I want to say congratulations also to our AMSOIL Twitter contest winner of Alex Lugar. He is at KXRider30. That is his Twitter handle. And he picked Russell, Sipes, and Duvall. And believe it or not, he got it right. Congratulations to you, Alex Lugar. You also pick yourself up $250 in sweet, sweet AMSOIL products. And we'll be getting that to you here pretty soon. Don't forget, next time out, you guys at home and here at the racetrack, you can play along again as we'll be doing it one more time. And we want to say thanks to AMSOIL for helping make that all possible. AMSOIL, the first in synthetics. And they got that out front performance as well. And don't forget, as far as the upcoming schedule goes, next Saturday we will be live with ATV Motocross live from the Ironman Raceway, which is the home of the Ironman GNCC. First time ever ATV Motocross racers have ever found themselves there this year. So it'll be pretty exciting. 2:30 to 5:30 next Saturday on racertv.com. And in 2 weeks, we go to the John Pinton GNCC live at 1 o'clock on Saturday, June 6th for ATV racing. And back at it again for Sunday, June 7th at 1 o'clock for the motorcycle version. That's going to do it from here at Marvin's Mountaintop and this Rocky Mountain ATVMC.com Mountaineer Run GNCC. On behalf of all of us here at RacerTV.com.